Good morning and welcome to the first meeting of 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members happy to do so? OK, we'll move on. So our next item of business is an evidence session on the outlook for business investment, focusing on businesses working in the renewable sector. This is to provide members with an overview of the outlook for the renewable sector in Scotland and look towards the challenges of 2023. This is the third in a series of meetings we are having to look at the current economic pressures facing businesses. So I welcome Johnny Clark, Managing Director of ITP Energised, Claire Mack, Chief Executive of Scottish Renewables, John O'Sullivan, Director of Onshore Wind and Solar, EDF Renewables, and James Reid, Operations Director, FES Energy. And if witnesses and questioners can keep their answers as short and concise as possible, that means we'll get through as much as we can this morning. So I'd like to welcome everybody to committee. And first of all, maybe ask, there'll be a range of questions from members, but maybe just focus on the recent budget announcement that we had in Scotland. Obviously, there's significant pressures on the Scottish budget and many sectors are feeling constraints. Renewables is recognised as a sector, though, that does require investment and growth. We'd be interested in your reaction to the budget. We do have the Cabinet Secretary here next week. I'd be interested in whether you think the budget has made enough commitments. Obviously, we had the Climate Change Committee report that came out recently that said Scotland was starting to fall behind in some areas and that we needed to see significant investment and pace. Has the budget delivered enough to do that? Mr Clark, would you like to maybe come in first and then I'll come to Claire?
Thank you very much and good morning, everybody. Thank you for the opportunity to give evidence. I suppose in high-level terms, there's always more that we would like to see being done, but recognising that there are obviously many pressures on the budget. I suppose from my perspective, the biggest challenge for us is around attracting and developing our talent. So seeing investment into pipeline of skills development is what we really need to see for the long term. And bearing in mind, we're talking about investment into a sector where the infrastructure is operational over decades, takes months and years to develop, and then is operational for decades. It's definitely a long term view that needs to be taken. So I suppose in summary, It's good to see the progress that is being made, and obviously there's the consultation out on the renewed energy strategy, which is good to see some of the content in that. So direction of travel is good. Could always be more, I think.
And Claire, is that a view that you would share? Because the budget, you know, there was the announcement around the Hydrogen Action Plan, funding for that, and funding through non-domestic rates that would target on the sector. But the skills is an issue that is often raised with the committee. Is that recognised as the key component enough, you think, by government? When we're talking about renewables investment, is it more focused on the sector and maybe not enough into the pipeline in terms of people and skills?
Yeah, no, so as everybody knows, we're in kind of quite unprecedented times. We've got an incredible project pipeline in renewables, one, you know, greater than we've ever seen before across, you know, a wider range of technologies. So, yeah, that does come with skills demands, of course, in there. I think, in general, one of the key pressures just now is the wider business environment and answering up to that kind of pipeline in terms of getting projects moving. So we were really pleased in terms of the budget to see focus on, you know, remaining focus on low carbon projects and support for renewable sector, because, you know, genuinely with the pipeline that we have, it is the greatest industrial opportunity that we have in Scotland today. And I think it's really important to recognise that there will be certain amounts of organic growth that will go along with that, but other elements of it that will need to be managed, and we will need to rely on some public sector resources such as skills development. But also some relatively unseen elements of that are things that might not necessarily come to mind, front of mind first of all. So we were again pleased to see a settlement for local authorities, an extra £550 million for local authorities, because of our reliance on local authorities to enable our projects through the planning system. Planning system's hugely important to us, and research that we had done most recently around about 2020, is between in that sort of decade, we had lost about 20% of our personnel in planning departments. And again, they are a key enabler of projects. You know, and being able to get funding is really important. That's the business environment point, but planning is also one of the key enablers of projects. So we're very keen to see planning protected as part of an economic strategy for Scotland, because we see these things as coming together as part of it, you know, as part of the jigsaw that will create the projects and the pipeline, which will then drive economic benefit, which will hopefully improve our overall sort of budget situation. Yeah, I think we need to be quite clear, though, about the pressures that are on local authorities and where their choices lie as well, and perhaps planning might not be their priority, but something keen to highlight to the committee that as a key enabler of that economic growth that we're all looking for.
And what about, I suppose, in relation to local authorities, with the impact of inflation? So while there is there's an increase in the funding, the real terms situation is different. And how does that affect your sector as well, the impact of inflation and rising costs?
No, you're absolutely correct. And the projects in the renewable sector, they go through different phases. So I've talked a bit about planning. You know, they sit on someone's desk, they're a desk-based project at that point in time. Then they become a finance project and a construction project at some points in time. And we face exactly the same pressures as everybody else in the construction sector. And I'm sure you'll have heard from them about commodity price increases, things like steel. ONS report, you know, increase in prices of steel is 70% to 100%, absolutely critical component of our projects. Things like solar PV panels, which, you know, had been a real success story in terms of cost reduction because of serial manufacture and various other elements and ease of installation. Effectively, the price increase of about 10 to 15% on those has erased that cost reduction. So, you know, we've actually kind of come back to the start again on those. So we are in this sort of perfect storm. It's not just around about any commodity price increases. Supply chain constraints as well are really starting to impact and bite on renewables projects. The way that our projects come together and are financed, generally, they will work between kind of using delivering electricity and generating electricity for the merchant market, which means that they hedge a specific price in advance, and nobody could have expected the huge increases that we've seen there, but also hedge in another way through the contracts for difference market, which offers a fixed price for the product, which again, many were not able to insulate themselves against that increase in cost, you know, bid into the auction at a specific price based on what they felt was going to be the ongoing kind of stability that we have seen actually for the last decade in the UK. So we are in a very sort of difficult place in terms of that perfect storm. The other areas where we're starting to see real change is, you know, again, in that supply chain space, because of high demand, not just prices going up, but availability. Very, very difficult. So we're starting to see unusual things like upfront payments to secure supply chain is something that's come in as well as those increased costs just for commodities and labour.
Thank you, Claire. You've touched on a number of areas that other members, I think, will look at in more detail. But I maybe invite James Reid, if James has anything that he wishes to add. The initial question was around the Scottish budget and whether there was enough, if you knew what came out of the budget, if there was enough that came out of the budget to support the sector and to increase the pace of change that we need to see. So I'll come to James, and then, John, if there's anything you want to add, I can invite you to come in after.
Morning. Yeah, thanks for the question. I think, similar to John and Claire, I think it is positive in terms of the investment and the funding that has been suggested through the budget. I think one of the key issues that we've had historically, certainly on show projects, has been the timeframes that the funding has been available for. So a lot of the time it's been linked to, maybe open for a year. So that has now changed, which is important. You know, keeping these funding calls open is key to help these projects grow. I still do see an issue with private clients. You know, I think the funding is very good for public. However, if you have industry, for example, it's how we encourage and attract the investment for these guys to get involved. Still seeing a nervousness for some parts of the market to to invest in projects, and a lot of that is down to current, cost market constraints. So I think there is positives. However, I still think there's a bit to go in terms of how we encourage it.
Thank you. And John, is there anything you would like to add additionally to what's been said already? And then I'm going to invite Fiona Hislop to ask questions.
Thank you very much. Yes, so good morning, everybody. So on behalf of EDF Renewables, probably don't need to introduce EDF, but I will just say that we're one of the leading UK island renewable developers, and in fact, globally, we want to be one of the world's leading energy companies. So we're very happy to be here today and to support the Scottish Government in their ambitions to hit net zero by 2045. I won't add anything to the budget question, per se, because I think my colleagues have covered that. But I will say there's knock-on effects, and there's other areas where that I think we could see that partnership approach with the Scottish Government helping relating to budget. So, for example, in terms of grid, that's one of our challenges. And obviously, working with grid and seeing that investment in the grid, as Claire said, that will help to unlock the projects. So there's budget needed there, even if that's not directly with the Scottish Government. There's still a role there for enabling that. And likewise, I think we mentioned, or it has already been mentioned, the route to market and contracts for difference. So again, in terms of budget, I think we could be more ambitious working with the UK and Westminster in terms of setting more ambitious budgets there to again help unlock that pipeline of projects we have in Scotland.
Thank you. There will be other members come on to issues of skills and jobs, but as a Mid-Scotland and Fife MSP, I do know EDF Renewables well as a company. And I mean, how do you find, placing contracts in Scotland? What are the challenges in doing that? Because obviously we want to see more contracts based in Scotland and more communities getting the benefit of renewables at the same time as making the shift from fossil fuels over to renewables, which is important for our climate change targets. We do want to see the benefit of jobs and skills as well. I mean, I think other members will go into more detail, so a brief answer would be helpful. But do you know, what is it you need in order to invest more into Scotland and into local communities?
The brief answer is, I think we're very aligned in that we would like to have that investment in the supply chain in Scotland. I think we are working very closely with our supply chain and certainly urging our key contractors and suppliers to, wherever possible, invest in Scotland and create those jobs in Scotland. So I think maybe a good example is our... I'll come on to the examples maybe later.
Please give the example just now and then I'll invite Fiona to come in.
Okay, certainly. So the NNG offshore wind farm project, I'm sure you know well, we have, I think, over 50 jobs in the local area that will come about as a direct result of that wind farm in the operations and maintenance phase. And I think there's a large recruitment campaign this year planned for that. But it's maybe too early for me to comment exactly on how easy it is for that. But certainly we're seeing a great lot of interest already in those jobs, and we're very hopeful that that will go well this year. A genuine, tangible commitment, those 50 jobs around the NNG project in Eyemouth.
Yeah, I mean, that's welcome. We do want to see more jobs, particularly in the area that I represent, which is an area that, of especially Leadmouth area, which is an area which did have a high employment rate and lost a lot of jobs through deindustrialisation. Renewables does offer a potential for them. We want to see that fully realised, but I'll bring in Fiona Hislop.
Thank you, good morning, and thank you for joining us. I want to cover outlook for investment for businesses, looking at current constraints, but also what you see as opportunities. And firstly, I'll maybe just stay with John just now, John O'Sullivan from EDF, looking at the issues around the UK autumn statement, looking at the latest support for businesses in energy, and also yesterday's announcement on, particularly on the business support for energy. As energy companies yourselves, obviously, I don't know how the implication of energy use for you, but it'd be helpful to get a sense of that, or is it more in the supply chain that you're seeing the knock-on cost impact? So what are the current constraints around business investment for you as a company?
So, great question. I think clearly we've touched upon the cost increases we're seeing. I think it's fair to say, as a business, we have great ambitions for Scotland. We have a great pipeline. I think we have 500 megawatts in operations at the moment, another 500 or so in construction, and at least another 500 to 1 gigawatt in planning, in our pipeline. So we have a substantial amount that we would like to contribute to Scotland and the net zero targets. And the reality is it's a tough time. All the cost increases on inflation and all our raw materials, but our suppliers, as you rightly say, are struggling. I think it's no secret if you look at the wind turbine manufacturers and their annual results, they're not very positive. And we then need to work together with the supply chain, with the developers and the owners and Scottish Government in more of a partnership approach to try and release those projects to offset those costs.
And can maybe ask Johnny Clark, if we can come to you, as to are there any direct impacts for you as a company of the increasing business, the energy costs, etc., or is it more from the supply chain?
So the interesting thing for us is the impact is there's more work for us to do for our clients, supporting the likes of John and developers, other utilities, and also. We do about 30% of our revenue from corporates and industrials, and not surprisingly, we're seeing a lot of approaches from corporates and industrials that are struggling with the increasing cost of energy and looking at how can they hedge that. And going back to the point that James made earlier, obviously they're then looking at how they can finance those, because that's a significant capital cost to them as a business, which, yes, ultimately will support them from an operational point of view in terms of giving them security on their energy costs, which is what a lot of them are trying to do. So the short answer is we're then seeing an awful lot more work opportunities as a result of these pressures, particularly on energy costs.
So it's a
double-edged sword,
yeah,
I suppose.
Yeah, no,
because then the next challenge for us is, well, how do we resource that?
Yeah, and it's interesting because we are looking at different sectors, and obviously, other hospitality or other sectors, it's a different impact. But can you maybe ask Claire, from your membership, what is the current status in terms of constraints in relation to investment before I move on to opportunities?
Yeah, I mean, in the investment environment, the outlook's quite poor. And that is largely sort of macroeconomic issues, but there are some things closer to home as well. So we need to make the environment as good as possible. I think that's the kind of key message here, is to make the environment in Scotland as good as possible. Because whilst what Johnny's talking about, and John and James will speak to you about as well, is that they have projects. There's plenty money, there's plenty of projects. It's getting them together and getting them in the right places. We are facing huge competition from other countries. So I spoke to a member yesterday who were talking about just creating, operational bases. And in Poland, they face no business rates at all, zero business rates, which is a huge difficulty. And we all understand that there are, certain necessities of public finance in there. But when you're sitting stacking up against countries that are close enough to us, you've got to be very mindful of that international competition for projects and for finance, and I think that's a really, really key point. I think the other thing that sort of linked to the first question is, and what do we need, is structured support programmes. So like I said, I talked about organic growth, but there are also some managed elements of that. And two of the areas that I think I would highlight is for heat. We are, the CCC themselves have identified this as their review of the sort of Scottish Government programme of work. Our programme of work in terms of heat decarbonisation is far behind where it needs to be. That's a very focused set of structured projects that we could bring together that create a portfolio which is attractive to investors. It creates that certainty of a longer term programme, which would be very helpful, particularly a sort of rural heat fund. Areas where we know we have to act fast, and again, hopefully, you know, hit not just business growth, but also look at reducing costs to consumers, because that's a key part of that macroeconomic picture that we're seeing is inflation caused by the additional costs on households. The other area that we've touched upon in the past is support for the SME supply chain, particularly in renewables. And also, you know, SME supply chain in Scotland is a huge component of the Scottish economy. And, you know, we do have, obviously, business support agencies through sort of SOSI, through SE and through HI, but we feel there's an opportunity here for a much more focused programme that does very much focus on the SME market. We're looking at, you know, I see this even in my own business. I run an SME, and in order to meet what my members want, I'm having to grow very, very quickly. That comes with quite a lot of pressure for small businesses who don't necessarily have the internal resources that you need, you know, to look at your finance systems, to grow your management capability, and to think about, you know, what a rapidly expanding business needs. And I think there was something very important that we could do in there to help support our small to medium-sized enterprises to grow quickly, to meet that pipeline and meet that opportunity that we've got. The other area, of course, is ports and harbours, absolutely critical, again, in terms of function, towards, you know, growing areas that can effectively operate as sort of Silicon Valleys. And we are awaiting, you know, with bated breath and ever more bated breath, announcements on green and green ports and free ports, because those will be really important drivers of not just the port infrastructure itself, but also in attracting those SMEs, those innovative, you know, entrepreneurial SMEs. We've got a fabulous backbone of those in the energy industry here in Scotland, and being able to really capitalise on that and therefore then translate that into the people and skills development that we're looking for. Fiscal incentives, really important. I think Johnny touched on this. You know, there's certain impediments to people improving their building structures and to adding things like solar onto projects because it enhances their business rates liability. We're keen to see that like pulled away so that we can really genuinely push forward on decarbonising industry. Scotland has taken the lead in so many different areas on decarbonisation of industry, another really key area we would love to see real movement quickly. And of course, you know, coming down to real sort of detail, fast tracking of projects, and a lot of that sits within the planning system. Delighted to see the level of detail and care that went into the NPF4 recently, actually, and due to come back to Parliament, I think, this week. So we were very, very pleased to see a number of the key messages that industry had put forward into that document heard and actually put down on paper, which will genuinely help us to build in more areas sensitively, but also be able to build at a quicker rate. And that's the key thing, that the resourcing of planning, really, really important into that rate of build.
Just staying with you, Claire, we just had the energy strategy and the just transition strategy published yesterday. So looking at opportunities, what do you see within that? And maybe particularly you were talking about, you know, issues for SMEs, and perhaps we as a committee with our focus on just transition maybe need to look at that. But can you maybe give, if you can, give an initial reaction to that? That would be helpful.
Absolutely. Again, we were really pleased to see the energy strategy published yesterday, and alongside the just transition plan, those things do go together. People are at the heart of the energy transition here in Scotland for obvious reasons. You know, we have driven the energy economy of the UK for the last 50 years, and there's no reason that shouldn't get bigger and better. And that was very much a message that came through in the energy strategy. Great to see increased ambition, or holding to ambition as well. Increased ambition, though, across offshore wind and onshore wind, the two key employers here in Scotland, to see increased ambition. Very, very helpful there. Also delighted to see a conversation about a target for tidal energy. That, again, is a really key earlier stage opportunity, but we are, you know, we've seen two projects come through to commercial sort of viability through that Contracts for Difference mechanism. A brilliant opportunity there, not just for here in Scotland, because we have a massive coastline that we can take advantage of, but also companies here in Scotland producing mobile and modular technologies that can be easily exported in the tidal space. So to work on a target for tidal, I think, is really, really important for tidal and wave projects as well. earlier stage, like I say, but there, that opportunity there for the taking, particularly in terms of supply chain, that industry in particular has continually spoken of and demonstrated commitment to local supply chains, and something that we should absolutely capitalise on.
And thank you very much. And maybe if I can give James Reid an opportunity to come in on this, if you've had a chance to reflect on the energy strategy and the just transition strategy you published yesterday, but give you an opportunity to talk about investment outlook opportunities, but also if there's anything you want to pick up on current investment constraints for your business.
No problem, Fiona. Yeah, I haven't had the chance to read the draft strategy. I have actually seen statement on it, so I read that last night myself. But certainly as a business, we see the renewables and the energy industry and market within construction being probably our highest area of growth for the business going forward, certainly for the next couple of years anyway, as it is. John and Johnny both touched on some really good barriers which might stifle that investment. And the big one is grid, unfortunately. That is a big problem that we have right now. Most projects that we're encountering, certainly on onshore solar and battery, is being heavily constrained by the grid and the constraints in the grid. So, for example, I've got three projects there now worth circa £10 million that are over the last 3 months. One's a heavy industry user, one's a hospital, and one was two industry users, and essentially being put on hold because the grid is saturated and due to fault constraints. So, and unfortunately, certainly from my perspective, I would love to invest and bring more people into the business, which I'm currently looking to do. But I also need to be mindful of that there is a risk there with these projects going forward that they might fall off or they might not happen because of external constraints. So that is a key barrier that I think needs to be addressed somehow. More clever people themselves. On the skills front, Johnny made a good point as well. I think one of the key barriers I see as well is the apprenticeship levy and access to that. So, and that's more from an upskilling perspective. So, for example, we've employed 6 graduate apprentices this year. I went through a process of trying to get 2 of my project managers onto electrical engineering degrees to try and upskill in the renewables market for them as well. And I find it incredibly difficult to actually find universities that were able to offer apprenticeship levy supported university courses. However, when I looked down south in England, it didn't seem to be as much of an issue, albeit you had to live in England, so it wasn't an option. So I do see that as being a potential also, you know, if that can be improved and assisted, then I think that would help upskill the existing industry as well.
So. Thank you. And I know colleagues might want to cover more skills and training issues, but if it's okay with the convener, maybe bring in Johnny Clark on the energy strategies. Is there anything you want to talk about in terms of investment outlook from what you're aware of that's come through on that?
I think my overarching comment would be great content, great aspiration. The devil in the detail is attracting the investment, the inward investment, to make it all happen. That includes organisations like the ones that we represent and others. At all scales, and overwhelmingly the clients that we work for, the capital is not coming from Scotland, and much of it isn't coming from the UK at all. In fact, the investment is coming from overseas, so keeping Scotland an attractive place to invest and also an attractive place for people to be based to deliver the potentially huge pipeline, notwithstanding all the barriers that we all see on a day-to-day basis. I think that's absolutely critical. So, yeah, taking it into an action, a detailed action plan is fundamentally...
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. And just finally, maybe just give an opportunity for John O'Sullivan to reflect on the opportunities for investment outlook, informed potentially by, if you've had a chance to look at the energy strategy.
Yes, I have. Thank you. And I think we've been invited to comment formally, so I won't I won't prejudge that, but I think my own personal reflections on the energy strategy and just transition plan are that it's very positive, and I think we'll be very supportive going forwards. I think maybe the one bit that hasn't been particularly focused on yet is around the clear targets that are being set in this. So we do believe that those will be really valuable for us as an industry. We can align around the key targets in terms of megawatts per renewable technology for onshore wind, for offshore wind. That will really help give us confidence, give the market confidence to make those investments that we can manage those risks going forwards. So we would welcome the direction this is going in.
Thank you. Convener.
Thank you. You have partly preempted Graham Simpson's question, but I'm going to invite Graham Simpson to come in. I do appreciate Jamie Hunkel-Johnson is wishing a supplementary, but I'll let Graham come in first as he has a question on targets, and then I'll go to Jamie.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks very much, Convener. It was really in response to what James was commenting on solar, and I think most committee members have, very keen on solar. James, your sound is not that great, so I apologise. I didn't pick up everything you said, but you seem to be saying that not enough is being done to bring forward solar projects. And I think if I picked you up right, you were saying that there are a number that you're aware of that are at risk of not proceeding. And I just wonder, in terms of the energy strategy announced yesterday, whether there was enough in that for people who've read it around about solar. So let's stick to solar first. I've got an interest in hydrogen, but let's just stick to solar. So, James.
Yes, Graham. Sorry, apologies for that. Can you hear me okay now, hopefully?
Yeah, carry on.
Yeah, excellent. So, we are a contractor, that is our business, so we are naturally the cold face, we tend to see, whether projects go ahead due to, whether it's inflation pressures, market issues, things like that. But the common denominator right now in most projects that we see as an issue is the grid. That does seem to be one of the real barriers that we're finding. We are only a small part of the wider renewables industry. I don't know if John, you've made a comment on it as well in terms of what their experience is. However, certainly in recent times, since the energy price increases, we have seen a massive influx in inquiries and people wanting to invest in solar and wanting to offset what their obviously their electricity usage is, also improve their carbon emissions. But the problem is in some instances they just can't do that because the grid doesn't allow them to do it because it's either constrained or it's cost prohibitive. So for me, there just needs to, and don't get me wrong, some areas that there will be plans from Scottish Power and SSE for herself where they will have upgrades and upgrade plans that may be 5, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 years away. But we're talking about the here and now. It's certainly when we look at the energy targets, 2030, looked at it last night, it's 83 months away. How many projects can we get built by then? That's maybe the key.
Okay, thanks, James. So the problem with for you is the grid. And in terms of the strategy announced yesterday, Claire, you've read it. So what's your thinking about what it has to say or what it doesn't have to say about solar?
Yeah, I think solar is a really important component of the whole story. It's one of the most accessible renewable technologies and one of the most sort of scalable. So it can work at a domestic level and all the way up. And one of the conversations in there is around community benefit for solar, which is new. And obviously one of those, it's community benefit as it stands at the moment contributes a huge amount actually to the Scottish economy. About £1 million a month comes in community benefit. How that's distributed is variable. So I think there's a good conversation to be had in there if you are going to look at that system all over again. There are certain characteristics that you would perhaps view differently given our current issues in terms of domestic costs for energy as well as business costs for energy. So you would potentially be directive about where you might put some of that money. So energy efficiency measures would be something that I think is a really, really important part of that kind of conversation and one to think about. Industry will have its chance to obviously comment on that. And I say similarly to John, I don't want to preempt what industry said. I've not had a chance to speak to them about that. But again, I come back to solar as a relatively underutilised technology actually here in Scotland for lots of different reasons. There are grid issues in there. Solar is quite an interesting technology. If you speak to National Grid, one of the ones that they've found more challenging to integrate on the system because less in terms of historical records, in terms of how it generates. We've got good records for wind, but actually there was not so many good records for large-scale solar, and it's been one of the key issues that they've managed down in the south of England. But now we're in a different place. We've got a system that now we've worked out how to build volume in terms of generation. It's integration. And again, that's where Scotland has some key technologies actually that will help us here, such as pump storage hydro. So a really, really important one. In terms of rolling out more solar, it's things like permitted development rights, particularly for businesses, to allow them to be able to offset some of their energy costs, which is not necessarily a grid issue because you would be using it on site. And again, quite a lot of detail in the regulatory space that needs to be worked through about just removing costs in there to make it effective and efficient for businesses to do that. And again, pushing that decarbonisation of industry agenda, really, I think solar is a really important part of that there. And again, the business rates point that I've made earlier, I think there are some enabling factors that would genuinely help us to link solar to other objectives, like say, like decarbonisation of industry and potentially possibly hydrogen, if that was the route that we were choosing to go down with it. So yeah, there's it's an underutilised technology. There are some barriers that are within the gift of Scottish Government to help enable to move it out. You know, if you think about again, the Scottish Government have been very active in energy efficiency and funding of energy efficiency at domestic level as well. And there are certain sort of upgrades that businesses would need to make in terms of roof space. You know, and if you're going to mount it on roof space, sometimes there are other investments that need to go alongside that, which just bump that capital investment issue and you know, looking at the programmes that we have and perhaps extending some of those to help support that, but also extending that to households again as well and committing, you know, more committing to continue that funding to help households make better use of electricity to offset their living costs, you know, be that through helping to them to move to electric heating to be able to make best use of the solar that they have, enabling capital investment from households in smaller scale batteries as well to enable flexibility from a product like solar, because you can actually, I'd have to go back and check the figures, but the one that sits in my head is that for around £4,800, you can basically kit a house with solar, and if you look at that compared to, you know, effectively what the UK government are now contributing to households in terms of, you know, trying to manage and mitigate energy costs, what would be the better long term solution? And I think, you know, potentially that's something that we need to have a really, really clear conversation about.
Okay. I don't know if any of the other witnesses want to say anything, but don't feel you have to. But... No, that's fine.
That's great. Thank you. John, did you wish to come
in?
I would remind the panellists and members, I do have a number of questions to get through this morning. If answers and questions could be kept concise as possible, that would be helpful. And if you wanted to come in.
Thank you. I just wanted to confirm that as part of EDF and EDF Renewables, we have direct plans to invest in solar in Scotland this year. We have a number of projects in our pipeline, mainly rooftop solar on commercial industrial scale. So some of those big companies that we're working with. So I probably can't share exact details right now, given there's some contract negotiations ongoing. But we're very hopeful to be able to invest in solar in Scotland this year.
Mr. Clark, do you want to...
Two very quick points. Agree with what everybody said in terms of the grid constraint. The point I would make is it's not just the actual physical infrastructure, it's also the capacity within the DNOs and the transmission operators in terms of their people, their resources. So it's infrastructure and people. And the other thing I would just flag is that what we're starting to see is, in order to deal with that, some of our clients are looking at setting up their own IDNO to try and circumvent or address that issue.
Okay.
It's an independent distribution network operator, so basically their own grid company.
Mm-hmm. Okay, right.
Okay, thank you. Colin Beattie, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Mayor. I don't think anybody is unaware that in Scotland and across the UK there are fairly substantial labour shortages across the board almost. Now, the transition to net zero will increase the demand for certain skills and occupations. How significant is this constraint on labour, skilled labour, going to impact on the renewable energy sector? And as a second question on the back of that, how confident are you that the skills and education system will deliver that pipeline of people and skills that you need? Claire, can I maybe ask you to kick off?
So while I said the investment outlook is quite poor, from what we're looking at in terms of skills, the picture's relatively good. Actually, I think the interest and ambition here in Scotland in terms of renewables is certainly, you know, when we did a recent survey of student numbers in Scotland, we've seen, I think it's a 70% increase on 3 years ago. So 22,000 students currently studying in Scotland in the sort of renewables and associated spaces, largely kind of engineering. So the skill shortages that we're going to experience are there. But we are, you know, starting to gear up. We're starting to see that. And I think, again, it's about focused effort on that area. The other area that I'm really keen to highlight here is what industry is contributing. So it's not just about public sector, colleges and universities and the education sector pulling in here. We've got a very strong framework of vocational training, actually, within renewables, which we're working at the moment to uncover. Because we've had a lot of returns from members in the last couple of months that suggest there are at least 20 resourced facilities around Scotland through the private sector, through industry, who are working to set up or are currently delivering apprenticeships, in-house training facilities, investing in learning, hiring apprentices, obviously upskilling existing staff, to demonstrate the commitment that we have as well as an industry in order to upskill people and help plug those skills gaps that we're facing. We're certainly, the messages that are coming from industry are all about upgrading those facilities, enhancing those facilities and expanding those facilities. We've seen, you know, one of our service group members have said that they've had 500 of its employees have received training or upskilling in 2021 and employed 20 apprentices in the year. I'll leave it there. That picture is good. It doesn't mean that we've covered the whole issue. You know, there are other challenges and skills in terms of skills shortages are one issue, which is finding enough people in numbers. And you know, there's also that ability for us to bring in people from elsewhere. Skills gaps, which is training and upskilling, but also skills cannibalisation is a point that we need to think about, which is, as we are developing renewable energy projects here, across the world, renewable energy projects are being developed, and a number of the people who are companies that are doing this are international. So employees that currently reside within Scotland will have that open door of opportunity to work across the globe on other projects. So again, it's about making Scotland one of the best places to live and work as well, to ensure that our companies can keep people here to work on projects.
Just on the back of that, what indications have you seen of people transitioning out of the oil and gas industry into renewables? Yeah. Has there been any significant movement there?
Yeah, absolutely. So we're the heart of that is the SME base that I was talking about. That's exactly where we're starting to see a lot of the crossover in there. And I think it was actually figures from OEUK, the trade association in the northeast as well, and who focus on the northeast and the oil and gas sector primarily, had talked about 75% of their SME members now transitioning into the offshore wind space. So they are very, very active in that skills transition area. We did some research quite recently, in 2019, which said that about 80% of workers in the oil and gas sector are aware and are alive to the impacts of climate change on their career choice and on their future job opportunities. But three quarters of those are really keen to reskill and would take the opportunities if offered. So there's a strong will in there. We are seeing that movement through the SME sector, but again, it's never going to be job done. The scale of the pipeline in Scotland cannot be underestimated, and does need that focused effort for SME and also individual skills training to meet the challenge.
Thank you. Could I maybe ask if Jonah Sullivan would like to comment on this?
Sure, thank you. So I was just smiling because I actually have an oil and gas background. I won't mention which company, but I think I'm obviously have personal interest in helping this transition, this just transition from oil and gas into renewables. Maybe I'm an example, but for my team, I've got examples where I've done this recently. And I would probably say that that's a key focus, but actually we're seeing transferable skills from other industries as well. So automotive and various other manufacturing industries that are good, relevant, transferable skills that we will need to transition into our renewable sector. If we're going to hit, I think it's the 77,000 jobs by 2050 that was suggested in the energy strategy yesterday. So I think, yes, oil and gas is a huge focus and is a very fruitful place, but we need to cast our net wider. And I think we need to work backwards from that 77,000 in a partnership of industry as a whole and government to make sure it flows through and we hit that 77,000.
Thank you. Johnny Clark, would you like to come in?
Thank you very much. This is really close to my heart because it is by far and away our biggest challenge. So we're a technical advisor into low carbon energy space. We're about 100 people. We're headquartered here in Edinburgh. Most of our staff are employed in Scotland. And a big challenge for us is accessing talent pool. We cannot get enough people. Just to give you some statistics around that, we're growing at around 20% per annum, a little bit over that. Our projection for next year is to do the same. We've got 10 roles that we're trying to fill at the moment, plus another 10 graduates per annum that we're looking to bring on top of that. And it's really challenging. And just to add another statistic to bring a bit more colour to that, it's also taking longer to try and find people. It's a relatively shallow pool that we're all fishing in, so our clients and contractors and other consultancies are all looking for the same kind of skill sets, and as Claire mentioned, it's a global market. So in the last year, it's gone from us taking on average 7 weeks to fill a role to 17 weeks to fill a role, whilst the demand is still there. So that hopefully just kind of gives you some context. An important part of addressing that challenge for us is developing strong relationships with further education and higher education institutions, and identifying the talent at an early stage, and looking to bring it in and train that talent up. But again, they can go anywhere in the world. And I mean, we've even got people based overseas in places like Argentina, the US, some in mainland Europe, as a result of us trying to access a talent pool that is more diverse and is not just based locally, geographically. So I guess those are all sort of challenges that we're facing, and I think we're all facing those kind of challenges. And I don't see that slowing down, quite frankly, with the aspirations that we've got. And there's been various reports done from an R&D perspective that have stated this or recognising that in order to meet our ambitions and the ambitions of other nations, there is insufficient capacity there in the market to deliver that, whether it's people or other parts of the supply chain around equipment, resources. So yeah, it's definitely a challenge for the industry and for global aspirations around decarbonisation.
James, what's your experience in this?
We employed 41 apprentices, that's trade apprentices between electricians and pipe fitters. So as a business, we actually targeted placing 52 apprentices, but at the time the colleges couldn't accept that number of we can get the spaces for them. Now, without putting the cat amongst the pigeons, so to speak, we're not sure if that was just on the hangover on just coming out of lockdown back in March last year on COVID. So our next intake this year will be April, May time. So we will be watching that very closely in terms of what's available in terms of trade placements within the colleges and what's available. I touched on the apprenticeship levy earlier on in a previous question. For me, personally, from upskilling, that would be something that would help businesses, SMEs, like ourselves as well, to try and upskill our staff. And also just to reiterate, you touched on companies, and I think it's Claire actually touched on companies that are investing in training areas. So we've just recently actually done that ourselves as well. So we've spent £25,000 at a training facility, upgrading and creating a dedicated workspace for renewables, where we'll have solar PV, battery storage, EV chargers to train our apprentices and also and upskill our existing electricians to meet this demand going forward. So I think from a private industry perspective, there is a real appetite, I suppose, and hunger to drive this change. And just touching quickly on the skill shortages, I think, again, I'm not sure if there's just wider economic impacts. Biggest problem I'm seeing is, as a business, we pay our electricians, for example, in line with SGIEB rates, that's industry standard rates. I have noticed in the last 6 months, companies out there paying 32% to 40% higher and over and above this because of the demand, and I get that people want to get in. The problem I have with that sometimes is, what do you do then with that additional cost? So do you then absorb that, or do you then pass that on to the clients? Now, if you pass that on to the clients, I sometimes think that's counterintuitive, because then that might put the project at risk because it then becomes uneconomical. So it will be interesting to watch the next 6 months to a year to see if the labour market does settle down, and also the potential recession coming in, in terms of the wider economy. So I do think that the renewable industry will buck that, but it will be interesting to see how it reacts.
Thank you.
Maggie Chapman, followed by Colin Smith.
Thanks very much, and thank you to the panel for being here this morning. I want to pick up on a couple of points around, one or two points on skills and then on supply chains. On skills, Claire, you spoke earlier about the interest and ambition being here, and I suppose one of the questions or one of the things we've heard is we may have the right skills, but they're not necessarily in the right place. And if we think of Scotland as a whole, we can identify what we need. But I suppose what I'm interested in, what are the barriers that you've identified or that the people you work with have identified around ensuring that we have the right conditions for people, for SMEs to function, not just in the Central Belt, not just in existing energy hubs, but actually across Scotland, particularly perhaps in rural areas where we want to see sustainable, viable economies?
Yeah, and I think, in terms of barriers, getting the right people in the right place, there's one very significant one that we need to be very alive to, and that's actually data. One of the problems that we have as a sector, or we as a trade association have gone out and created our own model to model jobs and in the here and now. So we've got a model that we've worked with the Fraser of Allender Institute, which tells us we've got 27,000 people currently in the workforce. The reason we've had to do that is because the data that comes through from ONS at central level does not give us what we need. It doesn't allow us to know right here and now or to track what is going on in terms of energy transition. So that's a point that I think is a really key one for the committee to alight upon. On the geographic point that you make, I come back again to vocational training. I'm a huge advocate of vocational training, having been to some of the most productive economies in the world. If you look at somewhere like Switzerland, their model is very much led by vocational training, and it's something that Skills Development Scotland have done and done a lot of work on over the last few years, and it's something I would very much urge us to look at, because it can allow us to get to places that you know, in wider reach in terms of geography, and it allows us to get more specific technical skills embedded within the economy, and it does allow that public-private partnership and a fast track almost of people to get through that system. So when we spoke to members about this, they sort of agreed that they were struggling to recruit staff with the required skills levels, and they were also feeling that actually their own training, they were having to supplement with their own training in order to get exactly what they needed in order to deliver projects. You know, and that is a partnership approach, but it is something that we need to be aware of, is that it's not enough just to open up more and more college places and university places and academic routes. The vocational route needs some focus as well. And again, that comes back to my conversation about SMEs and support for SMEs. Again, their capacity to do this is more limited. So if we can use what we have to help support a very targeted programme of work with SMEs around skills and upskilling, that would do us, you know, would do us a lot of good service in there. In the rural space, again, that comes down to where our companies are located. So you've got Global Energy Group, for example, and NIG, that's the company that I was talking about that have put 500 of its employees through its in-house training centre. James talked about their in-house training centre as well. And as well, we've got companies like RJ McLeod providing civil engineering training and skills uplifts as well. And they too are doing a lot of different skill sets. We've got good data now from that survey around what we need in the near term, but also need to keep a focus on that sort of longer term too. But the constraints there I would highlight is data, being able to look at and track this properly so that we can, you know, divert resources to exactly what we need and where we need them and when. But also to support some of those SMEs in their endeavours to help, you know, with the skills challenge that we have.
Thank you. James, can I come to you on a similar question? Do you think that we've got the targeted support and approaches right to make sure that we are getting we are supporting skills in the right places? And again, I'm thinking particularly not in the expected places, perhaps, but in places that might actually really, really benefit from this kind of economic development.
Yeah, I think it's all intrinsically linked at the end of the day as well in terms of pipeline. Unfortunately, when we look at where the majority of work is, if I talk about central belt and you know, in northeast, you know, that's typically when a lot of certainly our work is. However, if I touch on, we've got a business that works out of Oban, so they look at West Coast, and we are actively looking at how we target renewable projects on that West Coast, and with that will come skills development and trying to then get people trained up from wherever else. But it's then how do we then unlock these projects and the pipeline of projects to allow us to invest in that and get these people as well. So that is intrinsically linked in that respect. There's maybe not necessarily a clear answer. What I would say as well is in terms of ease and I think Claire touched on a really good point in terms of, you know, strategies and trying to get, you know, that clear path. It needs to be made simple in terms of, if I look at heat pumps, for example, I put 3 or 4 of my team on in heat pump training to try and get MCS certified in the last 6 months. And I found it incredibly challenging. And EESP actually done a body of work and I think the skills partnership. And there was 6 or 7 courses you could do, and then they had to do something else, and then they had to do something else. And if we're trying to target, you know, obviously so many thousand heat pumps to be installed by a certain time frame, you know, there's quite a lot of red tape to try and cut through. So it's trying to streamline those pathways and trying to make it as clear and concise and as possible for not only you know, employers, but also for colleges and, you know, accreditation bodies. So.
Thanks very much, James. We could probably talk about skills all day, so I'll move on to my next question, which is around supply chains. And I know Gordon's probably going to pick up on some of this as well, but just if I can come to you, Johnny, on supply chains, how confident are you that we actually have not only the resources in terms of materials or connections to obtaining them, for Scottish use, how confident are you that that's actually a long-term security rather than, you know, things right now, you said earlier that demand for your work is high now. How confident are you that we've got the sustainability of those supply chains to secure that demand into the future?
I suppose the short answer is not that confident sitting where we are right now, but I think what we need, if we do something about it now, or we need to do something about it now to ensure that that's in... That happens, and I was just reflecting on the previous comments that were made, and I suppose the workforce in particular is more flexible than it's ever been, and particularly post COVID, people have become way more flexible and adaptable about where they live and where they work and how they work. I think we in Scotland need to capitalise on what Claire mentioned earlier. We are world leading in terms of our ability to deliver renewable projects and provide advice and equipment around you know, low carbon technologies. And just to give you a couple of examples, we're working in places like Taiwan, the US, West Africa, Sub-Saharan Africa, the Caribbean. We're exporting our know-how from Scotland to deliver projects in those places. We need to be attracting talent to Scotland because Scotland is seen to be that world-leading location for providing that kind of know-how and capability. And I think that goes back to, you know, a lot of people stay where they study and a lot of people go and study where they think there's a centre of excellence. We need to make sure that Scotland is and stays a centre of excellence. So from a point of view of sustainability of then that supply chain, I think that's the starting point that we need to be doing that right now, because other parts of the world are catching up, if not overtaking.
Thanks, Johnny. John O'Sullivan, if I can come to you on a similar question around Scotland's supply chain for the range of renewables that we're speaking about. What do you see are the really the important things for us to focus on to ensure that we have the right materials, the right infrastructure in the right place for that 10, 20, 30-year sustainability?
Sure. Thank you. So maybe I'd just like to give some concrete positive examples where we have invested with the Scottish supply chain recently. So Forth Ports, your construction, coastal marina system. So I think that those are examples where it is happening. There's some positive outlook. However, I think we would share the comments around this being a significant challenge for us. We want to do more in Scotland with the supply chain, but it is a competitive global marketplace now. And so what we are doing is working with our supply chain to encourage that investment in Scotland. And I believe that there's positive things happening. The onshore wind sector deal that's being discussed and worked on, I know a significant component of that is around supply chain and how we can do more in Scotland. So EDF Renewables is looking forward to contributing to that. And again, getting more concrete targets of what we can do across Scotland to help us to unlock our project, because obviously if we don't, then there's the increased costs of delays, the costs of other companies having to come in from other ways, etc. So the more we can be proactive, that's probably my key message, the proactive with the supply chain now, that will unlock the skills, the supply chain, that longer term pipeline that we all want to see.
Thank you. And finally, Claire, if I can come back to you on global supply chains. This maybe seems as a bit of a left field question, but given political and other uncertainty in different parts of the world, what are the backup plans or mitigations that you and your members are thinking about in terms of human rights issues involved in the supply chains and materials extractions, the environmental rights surrounding materials extractions and that kind of thing that you and your members engage in?
No, it's a really pertinent issue, because one of the things that we need to be very aware of is that our demand for rare earth metals and other sorts of commodities are you know, going to have an impact somewhere else. And it is something that members are mindful of. It's something, you know, as an industry, you know, my membership as a whole is committed to living wage and compliance with modern slavery laws and all the sort of fair work practices that go alongside that. You know, we are an industry that prides ourselves on there. In terms of the wider sort of strategy around how to ensure that we have a kind of ethical supply chain, I think a lot of that is actually coming through different areas now. Actually, a lot of it's coming through things like ESG, so environmental, social, and governance measures that are being demanded by the finance sector as well, that people have to have good knowledge of where their commodities are coming from and how their people are being treated, as well as part of those kind of commitments in there. In terms of specifics here in Scotland, I'm not aware of any programmes that go on beyond, let's say, something like living wage and commitments to sort of modern slavery. But it is something that as an industry we are aware of, as well as the need to think ahead as well in terms of circularity of our product. You know, particularly here in Scotland, if we look at something like the onshore wind sector, very much focused on a repowering programme. And again, that came through in the energy strategy yesterday, that we can actually make use of taller turbines, which will then create a certain body of other products that will need to be removed and either recycled or reused. And again, something that the industry has been quite active on, actually, to date. You know, I think of one of my members, Renewable Parts, their entire business model predicated on trying to create second life and to enhance life for older products. So the commitment is very definitely there. As you said, that's very much a global issue and one that we would be looking perhaps to engage with through sort of larger partners, larger trade association partners, perhaps those based in Europe, but also thinking too about contributions from the industry into platforms such as COP as well. Always going to be a key part of that agenda.
Thanks, Claire.
Thank you. Colin Smith, followed by Jamie Hilco-Johnson.
And good morning to the panel. Can I follow up on a point that Claire mentioned, and that's how we actually measure economic success in renewables? I don't think there's any doubt we've seen good progress in the role of energy production in terms of cutting emissions in Scotland, particularly through onshore wind. But I think it's probably fair to say that hasn't yet translated into the maximum number of job opportunities. In 2010, the government's Low Carbon Scotland economic strategy promised 130,000 renewable jobs by 2021. I remember being told we were the Saudi Arabia of renewables. But Claire, you mentioned the recent report by the Fraser Valander Institute for Renewable Scotland that estimated the number of jobs was 27,000, the figure as about a fifth of that target. The first thing that strikes me is that was an estimate, because we don't actually seem to gather data on renewable jobs. The second thing that struck me is that yesterday, when the Cabinet Secretary outlined the draft energy strategy, the Just Transition Plan, he then used the term low-carbon jobs, which I think John mentioned, and the potential to reach 77,000. So that includes, obviously, nuclear jobs as well. He then, during the course of the discussion, used the phrase green jobs. So that's three terms on jobs already in the course of one discussion. So my first question, I suppose, is there's clearly a gap in the data. So what exactly should we be measuring when it comes to the economic benefits of the expansion of renewables? And how do I know, and how do other politicians know, that we're actually, it's the maximum opportunities? Because you'll all be able to tell me that companies are awarding contracts to Scottish firms and you've created X number of jobs. What you probably won't tell me is when the contracts go to an overseas firm, but actually, how do I know that it's the maximum number of jobs, and if it's not, there's a barrier there? So I mean, it's only fair to start with Claire, because it was obviously yourself that raised it, and it was Scottish Renewables that commissioned the work from the Fraser and Alden Institute in the first place.
Yeah, so one of the key points to make around the difference between the first jobs figure that you quoted and where we are today is pipeline. And pipeline is what everything comes back to. You need projects to create jobs. And we've got kind of a lot of opportunity here in terms of new technologies such as floating offshore wind and the tidal sector that I mentioned, where you've got a kind of a ground-up alignment with oil and gas skills, with existing skills. So there you don't start from zero, you start from a good base to work from. I think the measurement issue, we've kind of basically used a model that was devised, I think, by the oil and gas sector to help, you know, understand more about the energy market here in Scotland. The issue that you've raised about the difference between a low-carbon job and a green job, and a greening job, is one that Skills Development Scotland are looking at through the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan. So there are some good analysis in there of that, and they would probably be able to help you better than I can on that in terms of the measurement piece. We are constrained by the fact that we don't have a distinct industry code for renewables. And again, I go back to what I'd said earlier in this session around the sort of changing shape of projects as well, which is at some point in the process we're very heavily reliant on lawyers and planners for contracts and consents, and then we're very heavily reliant on basically the construction sector. And so the jobs picture does change shape over the course of a renewable energy project. The longevity part comes in the operations and maintenance point, where about 50% of the jobs are, and that's the bit that we really need to understand, because that's where you'll have your jobs for the next sort of 10 to 40 years. You know, you've got a pipeline of construction, and that will give you a boost, as we all know. You know, when you do a Queen's Ferry crossing, you'll see a boost in the economic figures that go alongside that. We're no different when we're in that phase, but the ongoing piece is that operations and maintenance piece, and that's again something that's very much rooted here in Scotland, because that's where the projects are. So, vessels that help us to get out to wind farms, you know, drone operators who help us to survey wind farms, all that kind of stuff, and new jobs that are in there too. In terms of maximising the opportunities, it is about sort of understanding the here and now and being able to meet the future demand. So again, that's one way of maximising opportunity, is getting better data now to help us forecast better, to understand what we need, and being able to use as many of the people that we have currently here in the country to be able to meet that. The other area that is really important in terms of maximisation of opportunities is to actually follow the path of the oil and gas sector as well, because they've been a heavily mobile workforce and heavily exported, not just the product, but the people. And that's something that we're really keen to see here in Scotland. And again, something as a trade association we've looked for from government is targeted and focused support to help build export capability. We've got amazingly wide reach. We're in about 72 countries. But as with most other sectors in Scotland, it's a narrow exporting base, and we need to broaden that to be able to maximise those opportunities.
That's really really important points. What I'm still struggling with, I suppose, is why do you think we're not measuring a lot of these things at the moment? Why do you have to do the work when we as politicians set targets, but you then have to measure what progress has been made in those targets?
Yeah, I think we've got good data through the current system on kind of oil and gas projects, and I think part of it is the energy transition, is that it is hard for firms actually to do the returns in such a way that it would be meaningful, but it gets down to that very granular level data, which is for example, if I think about somebody like RG McLeod, they work across a number of different civils projects. Some of them are, you know, roads and rail and that kind of thing, and then you have working on a renewables project, and the way that you do the return will impact obviously the data that you get. So I think that's one of the problems, is that capacity and resource in actual companies would struggle to give the granular level of detail that we need, because sometimes they are working on renewables projects and sometimes they're not. If I work, for example, in EDF Renewables, and I'm continually working on renewables, and that's quite easy to identify. So there is some sort of devil in the detail issue in there. I think the other issue as well that has been quite critical here is that if you look at the Office for National Statistics, they had to pivot quite quickly to manoeuvre themselves around things like COVID data. So things that we'd been speaking to them about, how do we get a better handle on what's going on in the wider economy and in the renewable sector, perhaps were put to one side to allow them to do that. But now we're kind of coming back into something that looks a bit more normal in terms of economy. I think that is something that needs to be looked at in
in very quick order, actually, is to be able to get us to a point where we can get better data. That certainly is the message that's come from my colleagues at Fraser of Allender, that that's where the issue lies, is getting the metadata, as they call it, or the microdata, not metadata, from companies, but then also being able to translate that through the way that ONS report in order to get something that's more meaningful. And I think capacity ONS, to be fair, had been constrained because of the key work that they were doing on reporting on COVID impacts.
Can I turn to John from EDF? I suppose I ask the same question, John. I mean, you said there were gaps in the energy strategy in terms of some of the targets around production, but for me the biggest gap was jobs. What is the target for jobs as well? Now, you might think I want that target so I can then assess whether or not you're delivering those jobs in Scotland and not hand those contracts overseas, but actually the real target is it would flag up whether there's a problem around the capacity and supply chain or whatever, the reasons for those jobs not coming to Scotland. Presumably, you would support having that proper data so that we can not only, I suppose, hold your feet to the fire to make sure that you are creating those 50 jobs in Eyemouth that you mentioned, which I've got a keen interest in, but actually it's the maximum number of jobs, and if there's a barrier there to that, we need to break down that barrier.
I couldn't agree more. I think we want to have our feet held to the fire. We have a good reputation for delivering on our promises, and I think we need to work together with Clare and as an industry to set those clear targets, not just for 2030 and 2050, but actually to break that down to see that we are on the right trajectory. So 2025 and 2030, so that we are going to hit those targets, and there's no unwelcome surprises at the end where we realise we should have been more proactive now. Doing more now. So I would welcome that work to consolidate and standardise the targets on megawatts, on jobs and the right terminology, how we measure this. And maybe the other target or KPI to measure the success of this is GVA and gross value add. I know that's been quite a well-used, well-known term in terms of measuring the positive impact on the economy. But I think there's a good discussion to be had, hopefully, part of this consultation, as you say, on the energy strategy and just transition. Let's clarify those KPIs and let's measure the success of us achieving net zero.
Can I turn to James? James, I mean, you have a very keen interest in making sure that we're maximising the supply chain jobs here in Scotland. How do I know that companies such as your own FES Energy are actually getting the opportunities and those opportunities are not effectively being offshored, if you like? I mean, is there a challenge there that you face, or is there so much work going around that actually it's fine?
Well, it's a good question, Colin. I think.
Sorry to interrupt, James. We are running a bit short of time. Could I ask witnesses to be brief? And this will be the last question from Colin Smith. I'm then going to move to Jamie Harkle-Johnson and then invite. I have two remaining members who may wish to come in. I want to give them time to take the opportunity. Thank you. So, James, yeah, please do go ahead.
All right, sorry. I think there's probably two facets to this. Through Public Contracts Scotland, they go through public procurement rules and companies. Yeah. Anyway, so.
We are having a problem with James's connection at the moment. I'll move on to Jamie Harkle-Johnson and see if we can get him reconnected.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'll make my two questions very clear, and I'll put them both to Claire, if that's okay. We talked already about constraints on the network. It's been an issue that's highlighted. And as a member from the Northern Isles, I know all well about the issues around grid upgrades and the like. I wanted to look a little beyond that. There's obviously kind of work being done by organisations like Reflex Orkney, who are coming down to the Crossbody Group on Islands today, to talk about how we can use energy better locally. Because there's a real concern. I mean, I was just looking at figures from from REF, which said that, and you may have better figures than this, but 3,460 gigawatt hours at a cost of 243 million in 2020 alone were lost to constraint payments. That's energy that could be being used, better used within communities. So could you kind of tell me how the sector can do more and we can do more as a country to better use that and avoid having to spend that money not producing energy that we could be putting into local homes and businesses?
We've put that same question to National Grid as in, do you believe that constraint payments are still the most efficient way to run the network? And they believe that it is for the moment. You know, the network infrastructure build programme is phenomenal. And again, let's not forget its contribution to jobs as well, you know, and very certain because it's a regulated sort of investment base that they work from. So a regulated investment window too. In terms of the constraint issue, yes, a lot of it's to do with management of the grid, but and not having enough capacity on the grid. But some of it is just the very nature of renewables, which is intermittency and things like solar, for example, when you know the demand or the generation comes when demand is lower. The key way to overcome this is first of all is grid build. That's a long term plan, you know, and you don't want to it'd be hard to see an investment in grid infrastructure at the moment that would be wrong. You know, I think there's lots of no regrets in there, and continuing to build grid is a really important thing in a country that has such an abundance of energy. The other key area that I think we need to look at very quickly and very specifically is storage. And Scotland has, again, some very key kind of geographic characteristics which mean that we are the place to develop new innovative storage, but also rely on some tried and trusted sources such as pump storage hydro. We've got some phenomenal companies. Again, you've mentioned Orkney as well. They're obviously looking at hydrogen into transport. That's one of the key areas that they've been working on. But also we need to look at different types of storage. So shorter term duration stuff, batteries, how that integrates into kind of more localised energy systems. And Johnny might want to come in and add a little bit on here. But, you know, pump storage hydro, which is longer duration, interseasonal storage, again, the role of hydrogen in our economy. And this is a key area where you are able to start to build out some new infrastructure, some innovative product, you know, new skills as well, and new technologies that will be of use to everywhere else in the world, because that's the key question now, is that integration point. How do you reduce that constraint burden by creating new technologies and innovative approaches to integration that will help alleviate the problem?
Just briefly make a couple of points. Yes, definitely looking at storage technologies so that you can optimise the capacity and use the full capacity that's there, which would address the first issue that you raised, or at least to some extent. And we're actually doing quite a lot of optimisation work on those assets. In other words, what could you co-locate either as another generating technology that's negatively correlated with the existing one, and or storage technology. So we are starting to see more of that, albeit there is obviously the sort of financial economic overlay to that. In terms of innovation, we're the technical advisor on the Low Carbon Infrastructure Transition Programme funded by Scottish Government, and we're seeing all sorts of interesting innovative technologies coming through that, and I think that and there are other similar things that are happening, which I think are really important in terms of, to some extent, addressing the point that you raised.
It's a real concern to kind of people, particularly when I'm speaking to them, that we're spending this money not to produce energy when we need energy and people's bills are. So I'll leave it at that, actually.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson, do you wish to come in with a question?
Yeah, I'll be very quick in the interest of time. And thank you very much for everything everyone's said so far. Going back to the kind of focus of this, the outlook for a business investment, I just wanted to ask a quick question about your perceptions for women in your sector, women-led SMEs, women renewables generally, women in just transition. And I suppose I would make the point, given the very fulsome comments about data, can you please make clear where it is merely a perception based on anecdotal evidence and where you don't have the data collectors in place? And off the back of that, where you would need to see data collectors in place. So perhaps you could lead off, Claire, and I'll just give the panel once in the interest of time to...
No, I'll go quickly on this. There's a lot of different issues in there, particularly on the sort of gender point. Gender has been one of the key areas when industry has come to government to look for these sector deal type approaches. It's been one of the key areas, not just gender, but also BAME, you know, also really, really important in there too. So that's one of the ways to secure more commitment is through those kind of the onshore wind sector deal here in Scotland, but the offshore wind sector deal with UK government, which obviously sits predominantly in Scotland because of where the projects are, and going forward, you know, we've got the targets that we're talking about in the energy strategy. You know, there is always that quid pro quo that comes in there, and how we do things, really, really important part of that. I think the other point to make here is the breadth of different jobs within the renewable sector. We've seen this come through the energy sector in the past. You know, if I spoke to my colleagues in oil and gas, they too have concerns over, you know, diversity within their sort of workforces, just because of the very nature of work tends at times not to be family friendly. Sort of offshore work, very, very difficult. The world is changing, you know, in that sense, in the flexible working and more sort of family friendly working environments are opening up. But in renewables, I think the breadth of jobs really does support our diversity aspirations, because if I look at what where our members are saying there are skills gaps and places where we're seeing shortages, planning and consenting is one of them, and environmental specialists, again, much more open to sort of more flexible types of working and much more diverse intakes. Welders and fabricators, turbine technicians as well, all open, of course, to all... all, you know, all people from all walks of life in terms of the diversity agenda, and something that the industry takes as part of its values as well, is very much again as linked to that question that Maggie gave us earlier on. You know, we want to do the right thing. We are a positive industry, and we want to be seen to be doing the right thing. And again, crucially important to how we present ourselves to the world.
Question then on data, the current status, and how do you know that's true?
Yeah, again, linked to the offshore wind sector deal, we've got data coming direct from industry, which is broken down in that way, and I guess it's doing a little bit more of that, but also, again, coming down to that ONS issue, is if this is an important criteria of what we want to see as part of the just transition, then it's something that we should definitely be speaking to them about, again, coming into that micro data gathering space, you know, what it is that we want to know about, what's important to us.
Johnny, I sense... you wanted to come in. You were nodding at the start of this.
Yeah, I suppose from a data perspective, all I can tell you is from for our business, and we have 50-50 male-female split in terms of our workforce. One of the things that I think we're keen to do is encourage more women coming out of STEM courses into the industry, and certainly there's a lot of interest, but again, it's so we're proactively talking to further education, higher education courses, and trying to get in there to talk to the students and raise the profile of the kind of opportunities within the renewables industry across the board. But yeah, it's really important, and I think going back to the talent pool challenge, we need to have as diverse a talent pool as we could possibly access.
Thank you. And anything to add, John and James, just to close this topic off, which I appreciate is absolutely vast?
Maybe just to say that from an EDF Renewables perspective, we have something, our policy is called Everyone's Welcome, and it absolutely focuses on diversity, inclusion, gender. And in terms of measuring success, then I think we are seeing more women in leadership team positions, but across the board as a company, and we would support an industry-wide initiative to track the, you know, the KPIs on this as an industry going forwards.
Okay, and last comment.
On my part, 100% know what Johnny and John's saying. I don't think it's a question from my perspective of the reality is trying to get interest very early on, and that starts with STEM. So that's high school and college leaders, increase that pool.
Okay, thank you, James. Your line was broken up a little bit, but I think we did get the gist of what your contribution was. I would like to thank all panellists this morning for their contribution to our witness session. It's been really helpful to help us in our work coming forward in the new year. I'll now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. So our next item of business this morning is an evidence session with Mark Logan, Chief Entrepreneurial Advisor to the Scottish Government. Welcome to the meeting. I'll start with an introductory question. So you've been in the post now for 6 months, so you have a longer working relationship with the Scottish Government and worked in other areas, but in this particular role, it's been 6 months. And I understand it's a two-year post initially. So is there a shared understanding with the Scottish Government about what's to be achieved in those 2 years? Is there a way in which to measure what impact this role will be having? So if you want to say a bit about that first, that we have.
Yeah, so there is a shared understanding in the sense that there's a remit for this role. I think we need to think about the sort of 5 to 10 year period in terms of what we're trying to do to really stimulate a dramatic increase in our entrepreneurial activity. So what we'll be looking at ahead of that time in sort of 1 to 2 years are the leading indicators that show we're making progress, and we'll probably explore some of those in our questions today. But are we overcoming those barriers that stop us being as entrepreneurial as we could be and as we need to be? What progress have we made in the different key areas like education, infrastructure, funding, building a network and a confidence in the country towards entrepreneurship, and starting to see the number of startups and other entrepreneurial activity increasing? So we'll see some leading indicators in the time I'm formally in this post. But what's much more important is that we're laying the foundations to create a dramatic improvement in our entrepreneurial activity that will then build on that foundation. So that's where I'm focusing my efforts, to not so much achieve, you know, very near-term, sort of short-term stimulus to the numbers, but rather build the infrastructure with others that give us a dramatic improvement over the longer term.
Because you've previously said, you know, expressed frustration at the level of bureaucracy in Scotland in terms of trying to make change, and also that they have, you know, concerns around the mindset within Scottish Government around focusing on economy. And I mean, as part, there was an appointment made by the Cabinet Secretary for Finance, but is there cross-departmental work taking place?
There absolutely needs to be. I think I'm not going to express frustration, more as a sense of urgency that the country as a whole needs in this area. You know, there's two really important reasons why entrepreneurialism matters in this country and why it's increasing the rate of entrepreneurial activity matters. One of them is that every job in this room and outside this room and across the country exists today because somebody at some point started something. And it should be obvious to all of us, and it's not a, you know, it's not a party political issue. It should be a universal understanding that if we're going to have a thriving population and individuals having fulfilling lives, we need to be starting things, and we need to be starting them more often than we have been. I think what concentrates that need is that we're now living in what I would call the exponential age, which is to say that our problems and the general environment we're in is changing exponentially, and our problems are increasing in severity exponentially. You know, climate change is one very, very obvious example of that, but there are many other exponentials. And what that means is that a society needs to be able to evolve its activities, the work people do, etc., to match that rate of change. And that happens through entrepreneurialism. And entrepreneurialism can be found, of course, in industry and business, but it also needs to be found in government. So when I express earlier, you know, frustrations at how quickly we get things done, again, that's not a party political point. Governments have historically moved more slowly than they'll need to going forward. You know, there's a concept of speed of iteration. How quickly do you iterate and learn? How quickly does that cycle operate? And if you look at an internet economy startup, for example, like Skyscanner, where I spent some time in its most high growth stage, our speed of iteration was a weekly process at most. We released software every day, multiple times to the site. The speed of iteration of all governments is not weekly, i.e. the decision-making frequency is not weekly. It's probably quarterly if we're being charitable. And I don't mean that in a pejorative sense, it's just that that's the nature of the machine. Now, governments should move more slowly than businesses because you've got to add some inertia to account for extremism and to dampen that, et cetera, et cetera. But I think as a nation, as a government machine, as a civil service, we need to increase our speed of iteration so we can make more decisions more quickly and make more speed over the ground to match the exponential age that we're now living in. So that's maybe a wider point than the focus for today, but that's my point when I express frustration. So, for example, when we work on things like the Scottish Technology Ecosystem Review implementation, governments are usually faster within department than they are across departmental boundaries. And we've got to learn how to be faster at running multi-departmental projects, etc., because entrepreneurialism doesn't respect the boundaries that we put up departmentally. We need to be able to work across teams. So these are areas that you could level at pretty much any government on earth, but insofar as we're in Scotland today with our own problems to solve, that speed of iteration is something I think we should be focused on. So I see part of my role, and not the major part of it, but part of it is being a constructive provocation on that point to your colleagues around this table and in government. The greater part of my role is really on policy development and then helping to see that go through to execution, such as with the Scottish Technology Ecosystem Review and with some other projects I will talk about, I'm sure, in this session.
Yeah, because that's helpful, because one of the questions I was going to ask, because it is a remunerated post and it's 8 days a month, I think. So it was just for us to get a good understanding of what the role actually is. That's why I was asking about measurable progress, and you've talked a bit about, I think, influence and advisory role to government about the way in which government operates, but also working within the sector and trying to make delivery on projects. Is there anything further you want to say about what the job entails? And I'm going to invite Graham Simpson to come in after.
Yeah, certainly. So I'll quickly answer that and let Graham come in there. So to be concrete and specific, on policy development, so the first piece of policy I was heavily involved in was writing the ecosystem review for technology. I spend a lot of my time in implementation of that now because it's an ongoing programme. I am working to co-author the upcoming Stewart Review with Anna Stewart on underrepresentation of particularly gender but also minority ethnic founders. That's a major piece of work that will be delivering next month, and that's very strong, again, on policy. It's written in the same manner and concrete style of the Scottish Technology Ecosystem Review. So what that's trying to do is two things. It's trying to address the fact that we still have an appalling imbalance in participation in entrepreneurship, that we should be ashamed of as a modern society. And it's also, that doesn't make us a just society, but also it takes away a lot of our best potential entrepreneurs from a much needed talent pool. So part of the job that I'm focusing on is how do we create more talent that's focused on entrepreneurship, and that's one of those aspects. The ecosystem review is another, and there's more to come which we'll talk about. So in policy development, there's the STEIR report, there's the gender review, and beyond that I'm working on a further paper to set an overall strategy for entrepreneurship that puts these other parts in context and will again lead to further policy development, which we'll be happy to talk about. Then, the second part of my job is implementation of that. So it's to steward that through into implementation across different groups. And finally, it's then to evangelise the topic inside Scotland and to work to connect groups and build a network of the willing to drive this forward. I mean, on remuneration, I'm glad you brought that up. The ecosystem review I wrote took me 6 months to write it and socialise it and discuss it, which I did for free. The Stewart review, I've spent about 400 hours working on that this year. I haven't charged a penny to the government for that. I'm doing that because I think it's important. So I don't charge for anything like the hours I work, but nor do I work for free. I'm sure everyone can understand that. So I've tried to strike a balance of ensuring that the work I'm doing has seen to be valued and people value what they pay for. But the vast majority of what I do, I don't charge the country for, because I think it's just something I want to do on behalf of the country and for the country and make my contribution. So I try to you know, despite headlines, I try to take that kind of approach to what I'm doing.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. Graham Simpson to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much. I'm going to come back to remuneration, you'll be pleased to hear. But you mentioned at the start, you broadly describe what an entrepreneur is, and that is somebody who has an idea and essentially starts up a business and hopefully makes a success of it. So can you tell us what businesses you've started?
Certainly. So I was employee 5 in Atlantec. I was a VP of engineering there. It was a small startup. And we took that through to a $180 million sale with Cisco back in 2000. I then co-founded this company called Sumerian 2 years after we sold Cisco. I was there with David Sibbold and another founder. That company, I stayed there for 7 years, eventually sold, but I'd left before then. I joined Skyscanner when it was about 90 people and was sort of stalling in its growth. And I took on the general management of the business, working with Gareth Williams, the founder, and took that to about 1,200 employees and a £1.5 billion exit to Ctrip in China. And beyond that, I've worked with probably in the last few years about 60 startups, mainly in Scotland, but also around the world, in advisory or investment roles or in non-exec roles. So, you know, I'm pretty involved in the startup world. I've spent about 30 years in the tech sector. So that's my experience.
That's useful to know. You mentioned the Scottish Technology Ecosystem Review, which you wrote. Now, I read that when you were invited to do that by Kate Forbes, you were sitting in a lay-by on the A9 when she asked you to do that. In terms of this current role, how were you offered this role? Where were you? I hope it wasn't sitting in a lay-by. How was it actually offered? Was there an interview process?
So I wasn't in a lay-by. Kate Forbes was in a lay-by.
She was in a lay-by. Me, okay.
So you'll have to ask her what she's doing in a lay-by, but I'm sure it was just a safe driving practice. So the role, as I understood this role as it emerged, I think it was seen to be very valuable through STAIR, the Scottish Tech Ecosystem Review. I'll just call it STAIR for short because it's a bit of a mouthful. To have an industry expert, if I can use that term, to take an independent view of what's needed in a given area of entrepreneurship and then help to steward that through into execution. So what that did was it established the concept of having someone in this kind of position as being valuable. That wasn't my decision to do that. That was a government decision. And then I was asked if I was interested in considering that role. I said I was. My understanding was that there was a process which I wasn't, party to look at a shortlist, and other people were considered for that role as well. I'm not sure what process was followed to explore that. And then I was asked if I would take on the role after that. So I didn't sit in a, sort of formal interview, but I think my interview had been over the sort of 18 months before that. I'd shown myself to be a credible candidate for the role. So that's how the role came about from my perspective.
So essentially you were asked, we've got this role, are you interested? And then you were offered the job. So there wasn't a sort of formal interview.
It wasn't a formal interview for me. I was aware that there were a number of candidates being considered. I don't know who those candidates were. I'm sure, and I believe discussions took place with them. Discussions took place with me over a period of time because I was working closely with government, but it wasn't in a kind of classic sense of coming in and being interviewed by a panel of three people or anything like that.
So come on to the remuneration now. The figures have been published. You can tell me if they're right or wrong. You are paid £2,000 a day. Is that correct?
That's the official rate.
Right. I'll so £2,000 a day for 2 days a week, roughly.
On average, if you were to run it that way.
So that equates to £200,000 a year, which is more than the First Minister earns. Mm-hmm. So that's quite a colossal amount. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a huge amount. It makes you wonder. I actually don't know whether you're a civil servant or on what basis you're employed, but it's a lot of money. And I can do without chuntering from a left because it is a lot of money. And I think we're entitled to know what we're getting for our money. So what does £200,000 a year get us from you?
Well, first of all, as I said earlier, the majority of the work I do, I don't charge the government for. So you're actually getting an awful lot more than 8 days a month's work. And as I said earlier, the Stewart Review, which I think is going to be a transformational programme for this country, I've spent about 400 hours on that, haven't charged anybody for that. I'm not sure how much free work you do for the government, but I do a lot for the government. The second thing is that £2,000 a day is what typically a junior consultant in Ernst & Young or Accenture will be charged out at. Now, I have 30 years' experience of supporting the tech sector here in Scotland. I've got a lot of expertise. I've worked with hundreds of companies. I've employed well over 1,000 people in that task. I know a lot about it. So you're getting a lot of expertise for that that money. What are you getting for the money? Well, you've got a Scottish Technology Ecosystem Review, which has essentially profoundly transformed the policy direction of the tech sector in Scotland. You're getting my stewarding of that through a complex implementation. You'll see, for example, we've set up the Tech Scaler Network, which is probably a first worldwide in terms of its combination of incubation, founder education, town square dynamics, and a platform to build on to create a great environment for our startups to compete. You're getting that. We've set up the ecosystem fund to stimulate the network of entrepreneurs and their confidence and their peer learning abilities. That's been put in place. We've set up a number of initiatives in education to dramatically improve our performance in computing science education. We've set up the Scottish Teachers Advanced in Computing Science Network, which is taking teachers and putting them in the front line of decision making so they can influence policy, curate best practice and share it with teachers around the country. We're about to launch the teacher upskilling programme that ensures that our teachers are properly skilled and qualified in computing science to make the subject interesting and engaging for students. We've got, another world first in how that's done. It's a network of teachers training teachers, so it's very novel. We've got a whole set of new resources going into teaching in terms of resources for teachers so they can teach first and second year students in a better way so they get more interested. So we've got that running. We are in advanced stages of defining the entrepreneurial campus that takes our universities from just creating tech graduates and instead creates entrepreneurial tech graduates, and that's going to be transformational. So that's of course been a lot of work. We are in advanced stages of setting up a scale-up fund in Scotland so that we have the ability to supply large-scale capital to scaling companies. That takes an awful lot of time to do. There's other things in the ecosystem review, but that's just some of the things I'm spending some of my time on. The next thing is the Stewart Review I mentioned earlier, which I think will have, if we implement it, will have a profound effect on participation rates for women entrepreneurship and also for ethnic minorities. And beyond that, I'm working to extend those ideas, use those as a platform to build additional improvements in how we think about entrepreneurship in this country. I'd be very happy to go into details on that shortly, but I'll summarise that there. So there's quite a lot going on, and I'm working with lots of other people to do it, but I don't feel that it's not directional or it's not valuable to the country. We can argue about, you know, what number is the right number, but I think you're getting value for money for what I'm doing. And as I say, the headline rates are not actually what the country is paying for my time, because at my choice, my decision, the major reports that I write, I choose to do for free.
Okay. I mean, the reason for asking these questions is it gives you a chance to say all that, which is really, really, really useful. I've just got one more question, if that's okay.
If it's brief, we can move on.
It's up to you, convener.
If it's brief, that's
yeah. It's just about... you're obviously involved in some other companies. One of them's in Travel Nest, which has had money from government. I just wonder if you see there's a conflict of interest, potential conflict of interest there.
There's a potential conflict of interest there, which is why I've done two things. The first is I've been very careful not to involve myself in those kind of decisions. The second is I've resigned that non-exec position to ensure there's no conflict.
Okay. Thank you.
I'll invite Graham Beattie to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Mira. Let me ask you a very obvious question. What do you consider are the key barriers holding back entrepreneurial activity in Scotland?
So it's a very interesting question. There are a number of proximate causes to that, but I think we need to look a bit deeper. And I think one of those deeper issues is a question of our culture as regards entrepreneurship in Scotland. I think back to the fact that we were once one of the most entrepreneurial nations on earth. I grew up in Clydebank, which was once the Silicon Valley of its age. And I think what happened was that we didn't update our model fast enough. You know, we thought we could stay in that world building ships the same way and having industry working the way it did. And then that was taken away from the country and it caused an enormous confidence shock. And then I think in the 1980s, we thought we could import a tech sector. You know, we got, you know, Motorola and Sun Microsystems and IBM and the rest to turn up and, you know, kickstart our tech sector. That would be fine, instead of growing our own tech sector in parallel with that. And then that all went away, and that was another shock to the country. So I think, you know, somewhere down the line, we lost our confidence to some extent as a nation and entrepreneurship. And, you know, we started to build a narrative of dependency to some extent, or a narrative where, you know, we're just not really entrepreneurial and all that kind of stuff. And that then affects how we think about it at a policy level. It affects the focus we give it, et cetera. So I think there was some element of that that ultimately, you know, put us a little bit behind where we could have been, where we should be. I would say, however, that culture itself is a consequence of other things. And I think the situation is not, it's not the cause. There's not the root cause. Culture can be changed very easily. Cultures change based on success. So I think if we start to, and we are doing this now, if we start to act in a directed fashion with a clear strategy, then people start to see exemplars, the confidence returns, culture adapts around that. So I don't think we're in any way stuck, or we should have any cause to lament or be sort of, you know, depressed about our opportunities. I think how we move forward from this point, in, you know, this addresses directly a question on what the barriers are. The first is we've got to normalise entrepreneurship as a career path in this country, and it isn't fully normalised. It's not the obvious thing people think to do. And normalisation is partly about education. So we need to be teaching our primary school children, our secondary school children, our university and college students about entrepreneurship. You know, our tech students at university should be learning how to be tech entrepreneurs, not just technicians. We need to be equipping our those founders we have in startups today with better techniques. So this isn't just about, you know, children at the formal education stage. It's also about people in practice. If I, you know, stop metaphorically, if I stop a founder in the street in Scotland and ask them about modern growth techniques. They don't always know the answer, whereas their Silicon Valley counterparts do know those answers. So we've got to bridge those gaps. So there's an education element to this. And, you know, we're making, you know, considerable progress there. We are, you'll see from INSET, for example, that there's a big focus on education in this area. The STEIR review has brought considerable focus to this area too. There's more we need to do there. There's an entrepreneurial campus initiative that's running. So things are happening there. The Tech Scalar Network is, although it's an environment, a network of places to incubate companies, it's first and foremost an education environment where people can learn, founders can learn international best practice. So education is important. I think the second piece then is infrastructure, and that's the physical and social infrastructure that goes with entrepreneurship. Physical is, for example, places to have companies, for places for people to go and learn. Social infrastructure is building a network of founders and, you know, startup people that can learn from each other and take confidence from each other. There's policies we have in train to help to build and stimulate that, but there's more that needs to be done. Funding is an area where we have a mixed picture. You know, we have pretty good syndicate capital for sort of early-ish stage seed funding. We're a bit short in the very early stage seed funding, and we struggle with the scale-up funding as well. So there's barriers there we need to overcome. But the biggest of all this is just attracting people into entrepreneurship. I mentioned earlier the Stewart review, where, you know, the population, for example, is a 50-50 split roughly of male and female. But only one in five founders are women. And that means we are taking a lot of talent out of the system, as well as, I think, denying almost half of our population the same opportunities that the other half have. So if we can make progress in that sort of area, I think we can considerably increase the talent pool. So these are the sort of barriers that policy needs to address. Getting the talent pool increased, normalising entrepreneurship, the education element, the infrastructure and the funding that goes with that. And crucially, we can't do those things the way perhaps sometimes we've done them historically, as a set of isolated, uncoordinated initiatives. That's why I think the STEIR review was important, because what it said is we need to take a systems view. We need to view the entrepreneurial ecosystem as a system. That particular review was focused on technology companies. That's only a subset of the system. But the value of a system is that if you can agree how the system works, if you can agree what its outputs are, if you can agree what its inputs are, then if you can agree what stimuli improve that system, then you can coordinate across different agencies and different parts of government to mutually reinforce each other's initiatives. I'll give you one example of that. I mentioned earlier the Tech Scalar Network. Now, the Tech Scalar Network has seven sites across Scotland with incubation for startups, with world-class education, and with a sort of town square environment where people can hold their meetups and learn from each other. But more than that, it's a platform we can build on. So, for example, we're talking across with the three development agencies in Scotland about how we can integrate grant funding natively into that environment, so that a company that's curated for entry into the Tech Scalar Network is also curated for grant funding at the same time. And we use the skills and knowledge of the development agency people alongside the Tech Scalar people. So that's a great collaboration, and it shows what's possible. It's a small example, but when we start to use the same model to build out a vision for Scotland, the next stage of evolution, I think, of tech scalers is to make them not tech scalers, to make them scalers, which is to say that we add other companies of different flavours into them. And I think that's extremely important. I'll give you a couple of very quick examples of why that direction is so important. I think we've all heard of Moderna here, given what we've all been through. Maybe you've had their product in your arm. Now, if I was to ask, is Moderna a life sciences company or is it a tech company? Well, it uses massive AI engines to take biology data and analyse it, and then massively automated labs to turn data back into biology. So it's both. Now, in Scotland, we tend to hold our life sciences mainly in academia. Very, very strong sector, but mainly in academia. We don't really expose that sector to the same expectations on starting companies as we do, say, with the tech sector. Or another example, let's take Pixar. Now, is Pixar a creative company or is it a tech company? Well, you know what I'm going to say, it's both. It uses massive AI engines and massive compute power to make those movies. Now, in Scotland, we have an interesting creative sector. It's pretty strong, but it's made up of thousands of individual freelancers and also small isolated networks of freelancers. Again, we've got some of the greatest schools on earth in terms of creative industries, etc., but we don't teach those young folks to be entrepreneurial. We don't set that expectation. What if we did, and what if we put them alongside our tech people in the tech scaler environment and other incubators, and what if we built policy around supporting them together? Because creation happens in the gap between disciplines, and the more we build around the same model, the more we get exponential effects. So when we talk about barriers, I think the biggest barrier is coalescing around the same view and then working to mutually reinforce each other's interventions.
Two very basic pieces that you raised early in your interesting discussion there. You're talking about an endemic lack of confidence within the culture in Scotland. Is there indications that that's improving? And secondly, perhaps deriving from that, can you actually teach entrepreneurship? Is that actually possible? I mean, could you create a class in school that would teach somebody entrepreneurship?
So to address that question first, yeah, absolutely you can teach it. Because entrepreneurship is, you know, there's different definitions, but for the purpose of our discussion, let's put it this way. There's a bit of luck involved for sure. So I'm here with my track record with a bit of luck behind me. There's a mindset and there's technique. And the greatest of these is technique. You can teach entrepreneurial technique. For example, why does the Silicon Valley in every generation of tech come out on top worldwide? You know, it's called the Silicon Valley because it started off in semiconductors, but doesn't do semiconductors now. In every epoch of tech, it comes out top. And why is that? Because it's a sufficiently large environment that in every epoch, a whole bunch of companies start. Most of them fail. The ones that survive distill best practice technique in that generation, and it becomes a playbook. Because people move around companies, it becomes a shared playbook. Eventually, it reaches other parts of the world, like Scotland. So the playbooks are teachable. And when you start to understand the playbooks, you start to change your mindset. Because if I was to say to somebody today, do you want to start a company? Well, if they don't know how to do that or how to grow a company or who to hire or how to create virality in a product or any of those kind of things, then their answer is, well, I'm not sure about that. But if that's normalised, then people's mindset changes and the culture changes with that. Then what you see happening is you get an exponential effect, because the more exemplars you have, the more that attracts other people. The more expertise you have, the more successful companies you have, which creates more successful people, which starts more companies. There's a set of compounding virtuous cycles that start to establish themselves, and that creates more confidence. And that's why, you know, when the convener asked me at the start, you know, what are we looking at in measures, etc., I think what you'll see if we follow through in the policies that we're discussing today is an exponential increase in the number of companies that we have. Because let's take an example close to my heart. I used to say in Skyscanner that when people asked me what would be my measure of success for the company, I said it would be if Skyscanner spawns 100 other companies. That's the biggest measure of success for Scotland. Because what happens is that people go through the, you know, hellish journey that we all went through. It wasn't very easy. And take that experience and join other startups, which creates more Skyscanners, which creates a bunch more employees who leave and start other companies. So that's literally an exponential effect. Another effect is in Skyscanner, when we got to about 500 people, we couldn't hire like a senior vice president of engineering in Scotland because there weren't any at that scale. And we couldn't bring one in from London or from the Silicon Valley, because if they brought their family over here and then it didn't work out, they'd have to relocate back again. Whereas in London, they could just walk down the road and go and get a job at Google or something like that. But once you get to a critical mass of startups, you can attract talent to stay, because if it doesn't work out, they just take a job next door. And the same thing happens with investment. You know, right now, an investor in London can go and see 10 companies today on the tube, or come to Scotland and see one on a two-day trip. So therefore, they tend to stay geographically. But once we get to a critical mass of companies, they can actually set up a presence here, spend more time here. So our task, from a confidence perspective, is to do enough to get enough companies starting to turn over that creates those flywheel effects. And I think confidence will follow that. So I do believe that you can teach entrepreneurship. I do believe you can overcome the confidence gap.
Just one last question. You touched on government policy, although you didn't dwell too deeply on it. Are there deficiencies in government policy? Are there things that need to be done?
There's always deficiencies in government policy in every single parliament, in every single government on earth. So I want to be clear, I am not a politician, and I'm not affiliated to any party. I've been appointed by the government of the day, and I'm proud as a citizen to try and contribute. I would hope that what I'm describing is politically neutral. It should just be obvious to everybody that we need to be doing these things, and I really hope it is. So as regards policy, from that context I've just described, I'm very pleased that we are focusing on this area. I'm very pleased that someone's in this job. And, you know, there's other people who can do the job, just as well as I could do it. I'm not claiming that I'm a unique individual on this planet. But I'm pleased that we have someone in this position. I'm pleased that we have focus on the ecosystem review and its implementation. I'm pleased that the Stewart review has been called forward. I'm pleased that the INSET document had a chapter on entrepreneurship, might not have done a few years ago. So that's all very encouraging. But none of the documents I've just described are complete. All they are directional indicators as to where we need to be going. So we need to keep adding. So deficiencies exist in the sense of there's more we need to do. So, for example, committed policy today is to do the tech scaler network followed by the startup scaler work. The extension of that further into the community to address what I call scale deep companies, that's something I'm working on just now, but it's not policy, it's not committed. So that in that respect is a deficiency. But I'd prefer to put it this way. There's a direction of travel we need to go on, and we need to stay the course. And the challenge, I think, for you and your jobs is that the course is longer than the span of one parliament. The course may see different governments of different flavours come and go. And if we keep ripping up the plan and starting again and reassessing things, we're not going to get anywhere. And I would urge us to find consensus on this issue as much as we can. I'll give you an example. Finland is a country of about the same size as Scotland, about 5.3 million people, something like that. The most sparsely populated country in Europe, if you put those people across its geography. Estonia is a country of 1.3 million people. Now, Finland, the last figures I looked at, has about 3,381 tech startups, not including other startups, just tech startups and scale-ups. Every year it produces a unicorn company. If you're not familiar with the term, a unicorn company is a kind of slang for a company with a $1 billion valuation that's still private. Estonia has three such companies already. Why is that? Because the policies that we're discussing today, the policies that I and others are advocating, they embraced them, they adopted them, and they've run with them for an extended period of time. And the rewards for their economies are massive. 10% of all exits, as they're called, when companies sell or go out to IPO, worldwide come from Finland, 10%. So that could be us, but we've got to stay the course.
Thank you.
If Megan Chapman doesn't mind, I think Gordon MacDonald had a supplementary. If you want to come in first, Gordon.
Quick questions in the same area.
That's fine.
You said earlier on that there was a lack of exemplars, and over recent decades we've lost large headquartered companies in Scotland, Scottish and Newcastle, Diageo, Bank of Scotland, and so on. Now, you were talking about the lack of confidence. I'm just wondering if that's been part of the impact, is losing these large global headquarters. And secondly, a lot of companies, including Skyscanner, instead of growing, continuing to grow to be a global company, you sold out. Now, was the reason for that lack of financial support, or was it a lack of senior staff that you were talking about earlier on? I mean, you know, is there a barrier that at a certain point a Scottish company has no other option but to sell out in order to continue to grow? And secondly, university research depends on a lot of public funds. And I'm just wondering about the intellectual property rights, whether there's a need for that to be reviewed so that companies and entrepreneurs can harness that and help grow the economy.
Yeah, thank you for your questions. To take the first question first about when companies leave or when they sell, you know, how should we think about that? I think we need to get comfortable with the fact that any one company is going to take a certain path, and very often a company will you know, like move its headquarters or will sell to, you know, etc. etc. If we have enough companies growing to scale, we won't worry about that. You know, it's like companies will take individual paths, and there's a natural life cycle to companies. But I think our problem is we don't have enough companies to get a statistical critical mass where that doesn't matter so much. So my way of looking at this is we've got to think of this as a funnel. Now, if you want more Skyscanners, you need to have, you know, like, for every Skyscanner, you need to have like 100 startups, and that's the ratio, or even more. So we need to be thinking about how do we create more and stimulate more very early stage companies. Some of those will become startups, some will disappear, some of those startups will become scale ups, some will become unicorns. All the way through the funnel is narrowing. And our task, I think, is to try and widen the very start of the funnel by normalising entrepreneurship. And then it's to stop that leakage from the funnel. So not every company should become a, you know, a scale-up, for example, but a company founded in Scotland should have the same ability to become a scale-up as it would have done in London. And because of some of the frictions we've talked about, we lose a few on the way. So what the ecosystem review was trying to do was say, what are the interventions to widen the funnel and to make its initial stage wider? And if we do that, we won't have to worry about those cases. Because the thing I think it's very important to understand is if you're a founder, taking a company from, say, this day one to the size Skyscanner was at in evaluation is an extremely difficult task. Like, it's really, really tough, and it takes a huge impact on people who are doing it. And you know, what keeps many of those founders going, what causes people to go into this business in the first place, is often because they know they can exit at some point. So if we were to make companies selling seem to be a failure, that's a big mistake. That isn't a failure. Those founders think they've succeeded, you know. So Skyscanner has created, you know, like, the numbers vary, but you know, up to 1,500 jobs, high-paying jobs. Support, it's worked with hundreds of other companies in Scotland. It's now feeding new startups all across Scotland with its talent. It's generated great tax revenues and so on. It still continues to do that. So it's not a failure because it sold. And the founders feel successful because they sold. And selling Skyscanner for 1.5 billion, give or take, has created a huge amount of belief in Scotland that we can do this kind of stuff. So we shouldn't view these things as failures. The failure is if we're in a sparse environment where there's only every so often one Skyscanner. So we've got to increase the numbers. And that, I think when you do that, the rest takes care of itself. But I think it's a good point that it was harder for Skyscanner after a certain point to grow in Scotland because we couldn't attract that talent in after a certain scale, you know, and, you know, would we have gone on independently longer if we could have attracted people with like great IPO experience in the tech sector? Maybe we would have done. What we had to do is we had to open an office in London to attract that talent. And that meant that all of our hiring wasn't happening in Scotland. that gets back to my point that if you've got a critical mass of companies, you don't have to do that. You can bring the talent to Scotland because the environment is fertile enough that they'll stay. So it gets back to that point on scale. Now, your other question, Gordon, on universities, you know, which kind of relates to research and maybe spin-outs and how well we do that. We are complacent in the university sector in Scotland, and complacency was our undoing back in the day when we were one of the, you know, the greatest entrepreneurial nations on earth, and we're complacent now in the university sector. We conflate research with innovation. Research isn't the same as innovation. Innovation is research that gets turned into products and services that get scaled to make an impact. And that's a very, very different thing, and it requires an additional set of skills. So if you look at the Muscatelli report, for example, which was commissioned into looking at, you know, spin-outs and all that sort of stuff, it talks about, at the time it was published, it was like, you know, 1,200 spin-outs in Scotland with a 768 million, you know, annual turnover. That's not a success. That comes out to be on average, like, you know, 48K a month, annual monthly revenues. That's not a success. So we're a bit complacent about our performance there. And rather than sort of, you know, trade statistics on this, I like to look at the inputs and ask myself, do we expose all our undergraduates to entrepreneurialism? No. Do we have incubators for our students to go and start their own startups? No. How many, you know, technical entrepreneur courses are there in any of our universities? Very few. Stanford's 165 just for technical students alone. Do we regularly seek out best spin-out practice worldwide and implement it locally? No. Do we carefully train our academics who are spinning out to be able to run a business? No. I could go on. You mentioned equity stakes. Some of our universities take a 50% equity stake in our spin-outs. That's the best way to kill a spin-out, because already I've lost half my equity. And I go back to my point earlier about exiting. That's just dumb. So I think that when you look at it from an inputs perspective, we're not yet world class, but we have great research institutions. How do we capitalise that asset in Scotland before it stops being an asset? So I think there's a need to shake that up. And the entrepreneurial campus that, you know, I referred to when I was talking to Graham earlier is one of the ways to really enliven that. Now, I don't want to suggest that all universities are the same. Some are very far ahead and are leading, and others are very far behind. But we've got to take that asset and leverage it in a way that we're not doing today.
Maggie Chapman, to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thanks very much, Claire. And hello, thank you for your comments so far. Thank you for joining us today. I hear what you say in response to Colin's question earlier about support. We should all be supporting entrepreneurialism, and it should be politically neutral. But I think some of the consequences of how we do that are clearly not politically neutral. And I suppose I'm interested in unpicking a little bit some of what you've said in response to Colin and Gordon around scale, around geography, and around that distinction between entrepreneurialism and innovation. And I suppose as part of that, the expectations around growth, because while I hear what you're saying, you know, that selling a startup, having a startup grow and selling it off is a measure of success. I don't disagree with that. Not all entrepreneurs necessarily want to do that, or the company evolves in a way that actually it can carry on being innovative at a certain size and not continue to grow. And I suppose, so I'd be interested in how we make sure that we get that spread, that diversity of types of company. And I suppose what we see, is growth just in financial terms, or is it in innovation terms as well? And linked to that, given what you say about the need for that ecosystem and having the expertise, the skills, the knowledge, the know-how in a place, how do we make sure that we can actually be entrepreneurs all over Scotland, not just in the Central Belt, not just where lots of people gather anyway? Thanks.
An extremely important point. You know, it's very easy for us in these kind of discussions to focus on what I would use the term scale-ups, because they're kind of, you know, there's some obvious advantages. We've touched on some of those to having them. We obviously would like to have them in the country. But I think we also need to think about what I'd call scale deeps. So you think of scale as a, you know, as a spectrum. Scale-ups, what do scale-ups bring? Well, you know, they bring tax revenues and employment, and they create exciting stories that attract people into entrepreneurship. So that's all good. There's other benefits as too. Scale deeps tend to be companies that aren't going to scale, maybe have 2 employees, 10 employees, and typically far more distributed around the country. Importantly, their product or service tends to directly benefit the local community that they're in a way that scale-ups don't. And I think that focusing on bringing more focus to scale deeps is extraordinarily important from a societal perspective. You know, I'm sure we've all noticed that Scotland has a lot of post-industrial apocalyptic type towns. And I think that a big part of really addressing that is bringing focus to entrepreneurship in these areas, and that includes social entrepreneurship, which I don't distinguish social entrepreneurship from other entrepreneurship. It's about innovating to solve problems and address opportunities. And I think if we could really stimulate scale deep type businesses, we'd reduce our social security bill, we'd make quality of life a lot better for our people. Now, what's the relationship between that and everything we've just talked about? Well, I think there's a symbiotic relationship, because, for example, I mentioned that, you know, scale-ups attract people into entrepreneurship, and that's good. But if you want to have more Skyscanners or Googles, you know, Skyscanner is not that big a company, you know, more Googles and Facebooks and so on, you can't grow giant redwoods in a desert. You've got to tend the forest floor. And if we have more, if you know, lots of people in this country are confident about trying to start a business and don't fear failure and all that kind of stuff, and are properly supported, then from those ranks you will see scale-ups, founders emerge as well, as in addition to the direct benefits that scale deeps bring. Now, I think over many decades, our industrial policies kind of flip-flopped a bit there, Maggie. I think you've had times where scale-ups are in vogue and tech is in vogue. Other times where it's not, and there's more focus on sort of community entrepreneurship. I think we've got to embrace the fact that they are symbiotic, and frankly, develop policy that focuses on both. Now, I believe you can do that because, and I want to bring in the other point I made about connecting domains earlier as well. You can think of this as, you know, a horizontal domain is let's connect the different types of entrepreneurship, and there's a vertical scale domain. All of them can exploit the same platforms and entrepreneurial infrastructure if you coordinate properly to do that. You know, the challenges that early stage entrepreneurs have are the same regardless of whether one scales up and one doesn't. So why not use the same infrastructure? The question is, how do we take the emerging infrastructure that we are building here and extend it to properly support the scale deep concept, rural entrepreneurship, social entrepreneurship, etc.? In the upcoming Stuart Review, which I'm anxious not to preempt because it'll be published soon, we have ideas there that will significantly extend some of the ideas we've talked about today to do just that. And this is a great example, because if you think about one of the many reasons why we make it difficult, or how we make it difficult for women to participate in entrepreneurship today, one of them is that our society is pretty sexist. And a consequence of that is that we expect women generally to be the primary carer and home manager, which carries an enormous cognitive burden. So it's much, much harder on average, this doesn't apply to everybody, but for primary carers to access the same, you know, city centre incubation spaces, for example, that you know, like a, you know, someone else could. So why don't we take this scalar network and make part of it mobile and actually go to the places where primary carers are? Because they tend to live in a radius, you know, you drop the kids at nursery, you go to the doctor's surgery, you go to the, you know, the shopping mall. You haven't got time to travel and back out to the centre. So why don't we take them out to where they are and make them mobile pop-ups? That's an idea that's been tried very, very successfully in certain parts of the country. That's just one example. But I believe, in summary, the opportunity is to think about the infrastructure we're building as a platform, continue to evolve it over the next 3, 5, and 10 years, but think about it as a general solution and focus on scale-ups and scale-deeps, because I don't think that requires twice the effort. And I think we'll get 10 times the benefit if we do. And I know there's other, you know, very important points contained in your question about, you know, limits to growth and what do we mean by growth and why, you know, what we're going to do to decouple growth from environmental and other damage. I think these are all interesting questions. Maybe I haven't got time for today, but we've got big questions in front of us. But, you know, taking a social enterprise and scaling it successfully, you know, so it's a great example of how we can grow and solve those kind of problems at the same time. We tend to think of social enterprises as charities. And because we think of them as charities, when the money runs out, they run out. What if we gave them the same support and incentives that other founders have? You know, how big would they get? How many societal problems would we solve without having to put more money in? So these are the opportunities available to us, I think.
Thanks. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson.
Good morning. Thank you so much for all of this stuff. Now, you have teased us a few times over the course of this session about the Anna Stewart review. And like you, I don't want to steal her thunder because I know something's coming out soon. But thinking about your role, I'm heartened to hear how closely you're working with her, because obviously in preparation for this session, I looked at the kind of key areas and I picked up the fact that there didn't seem to be anything specific about actively encouraging female entrepreneurs, which in my opinion, probably not unsurprising, is a huge gap. So can you confirm that you see that squarely as part of your role? And two, are you able to give us any flavour of the thematics of what you hope to see coming out? What does an ideal world, an ideal Scotland for women entrepreneurs look like?
Sure, and I'll be careful about how I do that, Michelle, because
yeah, of course.
As you said, no one wants to preempt the report. So to your first question, I think it's extraordinarily important that we address the appalling gender imbalance we have in entrepreneurship. I mean, it just seems obvious that we would see that as a priority category one issue. Why would we do that? Because I think we all want a just society in Scotland. It's not just to have more barriers in front of one gender than the other. And frankly, we do have that today. So do we feel okay about that? I don't. But secondly, we effectively remove a whole bunch of talent that we, in a tiny country like Scotland, we desperately need. And we need to, you know, de-anchor ourselves from the idea that normal is okay. It's not okay. You know, I've been in my earlier career, I've been in sessions where a director has proudly boasted that, you know, we're going to increase the number of female directors by 10% in this company over the next 5 years. But 10% of 10% is 1%, you know. So we've got to ask ourselves, do we want incrementalism or do we want to do something more dramatic? Now, I believe dramatic is possible. I think to talk a little bit about the Stewart Review, there are a lot of very, you know, good initiatives that are aimed at addressing this problem that have come along, and they do good. But structurally, the problem is the same. So you can go back, you know, 5 years beyond, the gender gap in entrepreneurship is more or less the same. And, you know, a very related gender gap is in tech, because a lot of the high growth companies are tech companies. And if women are excluded, to all intents and purposes, from the tech sector or have more barriers there, that's a compounding effect on the problem we're discussing on entrepreneurship. And I think the problem is we often, when we try and find solutions, we often look at the proximate causes. We say things like, you know, that women don't get as much investment as men, so we should have a women-only fund. Or, you know, women don't feel as comfortable in incubator environments, we should have a female-only incubator. We say things like that. These are just kind of examples. And the problem with those is those aren't the actual causes of under-participation. So those solutions are temporary and get undermined by the deeper causes. I think if we want to properly address this as a nation, and I think it's a huge opportunity to lead on this and actually get the benefits of leading, we've got to look at the full tree of cause and effect. And I think when we walk that tree, we will find that part of it is our society is sexist, has very embedded gender stereotypes, has a very embedded authority gap. And we've got to start asking ourselves, how do we address those root causes? And while we're doing that, what mitigations can we put in place in the meantime? It has to be a portfolio response. So, you know, we're looking at those. That's the nature of the report. I think some people will find it, you know, it'll polarise to some extent. I suspect some people find it too controversial or provocative. Some people will say it won't go far enough. But again, it's trying to set a direction, a different narrative on this issue than we've had in Scotland before. Anna and I are very keen that we move away from this idea of how do we fix women so they're more entrepreneurial, if only they were more confident. Yeah, yeah. You know, the last time I was in this parliament physically doing a session similar to this one, I was speaking to someone at the end, and she said, you know, in my company, the company's sending the women managers on a course to be so they can be more aggressive and more this and more that, like men. It's like, why isn't the company sending the men in the course to be more like women? So we've got to stop trying to fix women to address entrepreneurial under participation. We've really got to fix society, and we've got to mitigate the consequences of its current unfixed state. And we've got to, those mitigations have got to be more profound than they've been. And I believe we can do that. Not naive about that, but there's no point just another review saying, you know, let's set up a confidence course for women and then let's move on. You know, there's no longer time for tick boxing. And my comments at the start about the crisis we're in, this country is going to experience, this species, this planet is going to experience exponential change that's going to be bewildering. If we can't put our best minds at scale onto those problems for this country and for the wider humanity that we're in, then we're in big, big trouble. And those post-apocalyptic or post-industrial apocalyptic wastelands I mentioned earlier will look tame in comparison to what's coming. So that absolutely requires us to evolve our best people involved in this. And a big part of that is having those women who want to follow entrepreneurial career paths having the same access to those paths as men do, I think.
Thank you very much. I'm very, very much looking forward to reading the review. Just one more question, which kind of takes us back to where we started. The first thing you mentioned was around culture. And this, thus far, you've not really reflected much on attitude to risk and our perception of failure culturally. So I'd like some reflections on that. And I know you said at the beginning culture can be changed very easily, but it does seem to me that something about our risk appetite and our attitude is deeply ingrained, and how we perceive failure, which of course is simply learning in business terms. But I'd like some just finishing reflections on that. Thank you.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, there's a statistic, I don't know how valid it is, but it's probably in the right ballpark, that on average, successful founders had 5 failures before their 6th company. So you can see that if we don't tolerate failure, we ain't going to tolerate success either. And I think something that comes out quite often in the data, when people look at, you know, how entrepreneurial is Scotland, is a fear of failure. It's a cultural thing. Now, how to address that? What I'm seeing, and I apologise, this is anecdotal, but it's anecdotal at scale, I guess you could say, is that we have a generation of founders coming through now. And when I say what I'm going to say, I don't mean to disregard older founders. You know, I'm older than I was once, and I want to still be part of this debate. But there's a generation of founders coming through who have grown up in a different age. They don't remember all the shipyards closing down in Clydebank and everywhere else. They don't believe that they should grow up in a managed decline policy as it was when I was growing up. They live in an internet age where every customer on earth is adjacent to them in a way that wasn't the case when we were struggling to maintain our steel industry and all those kind of things. Every competitor too, so they have to be very good founders, but every customer is available. And the internet has widely propagated exemplar stories, you know, narratives about how companies succeeded and failed. So those younger founders are much more comfortable with the idea that they might not succeed first time, because that's what they're seeing in their peer group. Where do they see their peer group? It's not in Scotland, it's international. So the founders they admire didn't succeed the first time, or, you know, made big mistakes and recovered from them. So they don't have the same fear of failure. And I think the more we see successful Scottish companies and the more we hear those founders talk about failure, the more that it becomes okay. And, you know, for example, there's an organisation that's running events in Scotland. I won't say its name because it's a rude word, but it's called Up Nights, where people just stand up and say, here's how I screwed up. And this is what I learned from it. And people are talking about those stories and less scared to do that. So I think it is happening. You know, we are making that progress. And I'm seeing founders fail, very good young founders, who are getting back in the saddle and trying again. So I think it's happening. And, I always believe that networks trump hierarchies. There's what we think we can do, you know, in government or, you know, people in my position, what we can say to encourage people. But actually, people take the reference points from the network, from the people who are like them, from experiencing what they're experiencing. And as they see the network experience failure at more scale and recover from it, they'll be better equipped to deal with that. And I think that is starting to happen. So, you know, I think we need to, in Scotland, switch the narrative from why we can't do stuff to how we can do stuff. And that's important because what we say affects people. And so rather than talk about barriers, I want to talk about things we can do. And I think we are starting to do them. And that's creating that network effect. You know, it's creating a common voice, a common belief, common direction, more exemplars. And those will just feed the engine. So I think we're on the right road there.
Jamie Harker-Johnson.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks very much for coming in. I've got a number of questions. Some have been covered by colleagues, as always the way, but there's some questions around the economy and also about some of the regional stuff. But I did want to follow up on some of the questions that you answered earlier to my colleague Graham Simpson. You've got a number of hats. You obviously were doing the review, but you're now the chief entrepreneur. I was just wondering what the nature of your role is in terms of the employment with the Scottish Government. Are you a contractor? Are you paid directly or through a company? Are you a civil servant or a special advisor subject to a code of conduct? Are you directly employed? What's the nature of that relationship?
So the nature is I am employed through contract or through my. I have a company which is my consulting vehicle, and I'm paid via that vehicle. By contract.
Okay, all right. And I suppose, again, on the questions that were asked earlier, you talked about the process of your appointment. And you also talked about 30 years of experience, decades within business. Would you have employed somebody without a formal interview process?
Sometimes, yes. Absolutely. If I had a person in front of me who was ideally qualified, I would be. They would be interviewing me. That's very common in the scale up startup world. The important thing is talent in that world and acquiring that talent. Now, I can't and won't speak to how the process works. That's for others to do that. I can tell you what my involvement in it was. In some ways, I could view my interview process as being the prior experience I had, the STAIR review, and then very intense follow-up to the STAIR review that I worked on, discussions about the role. As I say, I'm aware there were other candidates, so it certainly wasn't all me. I don't know what the nature of those discussions were, but I can only tell you what I've seen. Some will take a view that that was a good decision, some will take a view that it was a bad decision or wrong process. But I'd have to direct you elsewhere for that.
Well, I suppose we'll find out at the end of the kind of period. But so, you were confident that the government knew you well enough and, over your kind of their experience of you and the like. OK, I wanted to ask two areas. You said in an interview in August 2020 that still not enough focus on the economy for the Scottish government. That was only a few months ago. Has anything changed or is it still at your concern?
I would like to see increasing focus on the issue, yes. Now, you might expect me to say that, and I'm very conscious in my position that I don't have the responsibilities of government. Like, I don't have to, also address, fair pay in a very difficult current climate and a whole bunch of issues that I don't even have exposure to. But from my perspective, I would always like to see more. And if you found me saying, you know what, Jamie, I think we've got enough focus on this, you should be concerned. To be more specific, I think we have a really exciting direction on entrepreneurship underway, and I'm frankly grateful to the folks in the government I'm working with that they're giving that time and attention. I'm grateful to Cabinet Secretary Forbes that she commissioned the STAIR review. I think everyone in the tech sector is grateful that happened. And that she supported the things we're doing so closely, as an example. So I'm not saying that there's like a catastrophic lack of focus. There's some very good things happening, but what I want to see is those things implemented as quickly as possible. And I realise that goes into a wider process, and that's a difficult process. So you're always going to hear me saying that, because I think we can always go faster in this area. I think if we do that, we then create more tax revenues, better well-being, more jobs for people, which I think helps with those other nearer-term problems. So that's why I think it's important. So, yes, I'm always restless, and I should be restless on this issue.
We've talked about things like particularly the Scottish National Investment Bank and some of the work that they've done. But obviously the enterprise bodies and the regional enterprise bodies like Highlands and Islands Enterprise and Scottish Enterprise South of Scotland, how important are they in terms of the business support, in terms of encouraging entrepreneurs? There are lots of different kind of areas that support can be given, but how important are they, and what do you see their role going forward?
So I think that they're a great asset, in summary. I think there's a lot of work that is done by our agencies that they can't brag about on social media because they would be criticised for that, but it's very much appreciated by the companies they work with. Again, I'm sure they could move faster and all those kind of things, but there's a lot of good work done there. I've been working recently closely with Scottish Enterprise, for example, which is obviously the biggest of these agencies, and I've been very happy with the level of collaboration I'm seeing, led by Adrian Gillespie and his team, on how we can embrace and amplify the work we're doing in STAIR, for example. So I think they've a very important part to play. There's a lot of expertise inside these agencies, which, again, sometimes goes unnoticed, but is appreciated on the ground. So I don't have any great criticisms of what I'm seeing. I'm delighted that there's a good engagement. We can always do more together. I like the fact that as a whole, our agencies and our other bodies are starting to coalesce around the same view, the same model I referred to earlier, the same system model, so we can start to reinforce each other's implementations. So I'm pretty happy that we're starting to go in the right direction there.
And you talked about kind of confidence. Scotland has a great entrepreneurial past. I'm from the Northern Isles. I think we consider ourselves still of that way. And there are companies like Kylo Partners that are based in Kirkcall. But just on the point that you were talking to Maggie about, it's vital, as you say, that we don't just focus on the Central Belt or the Northeast or areas which perhaps have traditional basis. So what do you see as the barriers to you delivering a kind of entrepreneurship agenda across the whole of Scotland, particularly perhaps the remote areas?
So I think it's important to remember that if you look at in a rural population, proportionately more people are entrepreneurial in that environment, partly from necessity. But I think, again, it shows us that entrepreneurialism is innate. The reason we're all still here as a species is because our ancestors entrepreneurially solved survival problems. So we have that latent potential. I think it's very important we don't see rural entrepreneurship as a problem to be fixed, but rather as an opportunity to be leveraged. It's easy to fall into a model that says, we've got an alpha city here in Edinburgh, relatively speaking, and the rest of the country is a problem to be fixed. We've got to see rural entrepreneurship as a network that we can strengthen. And I think what that requires us to do is, when we're designing policy, so I've talked about things like incubation, founder education, building a network of like-minded individuals, the right type of funding, etc., that we natively design those to work for rural entrepreneurs. And I believe if we do that, that will also work for city dwellers as well. Whereas if you do it the other way around, often it doesn't work for the rural entrepreneur. So for example, if we take the Scalar network, and I don't want to over-index on this, but just as an example, because it's one we've all heard of, and add a mobile component to that so that it can be in rural areas and bring expertise and bring digital marketing skills, business skills, bring appropriate micro grants, bring people physically together in a network and so on and so forth, and it moves around those areas. That's one example of how you can design a resource that's previously considered to be static and city centre based, bring it to the rural communities. And I'm doing quite a lot of work with, for example, Jackie Brereton and GrowBiz to understand how she thinks about that issue. But the interesting thing I think there, Jamie, is if you do that, the same solution will work for primary carers, for example, because they can't always be in those same places. So it's another example of the same solutions can work for multiple entrepreneurial categories if we think about it in a properly systematic way.
I suppose it was that question around infrastructure, and it's, it could be broadband, it could be transport, it could be homes, it could be all of these things that can often be a big barrier. I know we have issues in city centres as well, particularly on the housing issue, but it's those infrastructure issues that can often be a real barrier to somebody choosing to build their business on an island or
The requirement for very high-speed broadband across the country, I mean, I think it's been well reviewed and discussed probably by this committee, other areas, but, you know, of course it's extremely important. I think we've also got to think about, you know, rural entrepreneurship and entrepreneurship in disadvantaged city areas often have the same problems, often lack of access to basic infrastructure like, good internet connectivity, incubation, etc. So there's a lot of lost entrepreneurial talent in those areas too, and I think we've got to make sure that we are solving that in a layered way. So I look at the provision of internet. It's not really a capital spend issue. You can always find capital spend, it seems, but who's going to pay the internet bill every month? That's not capital spend. And if the answer is, well, no department of government or elsewhere wants to do it, then the capital spend amounts to nothing. So we can solve these problems, and we've got to start solving them, because I think we owe it to our citizens to find ways through these kind of logistical challenges. But going back to the point, again, I think if you solve for rural entrepreneurship, you probably also solve for inner city entrepreneurship, and you probably also solve for people in more fortunate positions.
Thank you.
I have a request from Graeme Simpson for a very short supplementary.
It's very short. I want to thank you for what you've said today. I think you've come across really well. Are you going to be producing progress reports for the government and for this committee?
Yes. I'm not currently producing those against my work, but rather through the work I'm doing. So to give you an example of that, we've just published the STAIR 2-year progress review. I think it came out in November or early December, which is a programme that I'm very, very, very actively involved in. Likewise, I expect we'll do the same with the Stuart review, which I'll stay very close to. If members would prefer, or additionally, take of all my individual activity across those things, I'm very happy to consider doing that and producing such a report regularly. So I'd be happy to consider that.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's helpful. And the clerks and I will discuss how we develop the future relationship. But I'd like to thank you very much for the evidence that you have brought to us this morning and for being so generous with your time. I'll now move into a private session.